good one.
Good morning.
Good morning. What a good song.
You like that one?
Shut up.
Run DMC.
Yes.
You've always been a Run DMC fan.
I like them very much.
Yeah.
They hold up. We're going to address, obviously, some things that have been happening on Twitter. But we have Sully from Godsmack here today. This week was 8 to 11 we're doing. So a lot of these bookings Roland made before when we were starting at 7.
Right.
So they were bookings that were intended to be an hour into the show. But then we started at 8, so it seems like, why are these guys just starting immediately? So we're just, you know, this week is technically still, you know, we're still under the old contract. This is not...
Right. And going forward, we wouldn't be starting with guests every day.
Not normally, no, but these were supposed to be booked an hour into the show.
And we like everybody that's coming in. We weren't going to cancel anybody.
I'm happy that we didn't want to cancel Sully, and he couldn't move because he has other stuff. So we're happy just to hang with him. But yeah, we'll address stuff, obviously.
What's going on in the Twitterverse?
Yeah, I think it should be addressed.
Yeah, we'll talk about that after Sully comes in.
Yes.
It's Jim Norton and Sam Roberts, of course.
Yeah, and happy birthday, Lori. I normally don't do those, but I just happened to catch someone on Twitter.
Yeah, we don't do happy birthdays here.
I don't think I've done one in 15 years, but I think there I had to.
Oh, boy. Scorch, so you would get the big fail from Scorch for today.
Would I really?
He did not. He refused.
Oh,
he'll
no.
do any hack trick in the book. But he refused to wish anybody happy birthday on the air.
People have wished me a happy birthday so many times, it makes me feel so good.
Well, you like it when people call up every day and just go, happy birthday, Jimmy.
No, I don't at
you
all.
Don't?
No, I don't. Don't teff me either. How was Green Day? Where's Sully?
Oh, Green Day was awesome.
Yeah?
Yeah.
Where did they play last night?
Starland Ballroom in Jersey.
Oh, yeah. I've been there. That's a good...
It's a small club.
Yeah.
What time did you get home?
Like 11:30.
Wow.
Yeah, but these hours, I'm not losing that much sleep, you know?
Oh, that's right.
Because you get to start an hour more sleep.
Yeah.
Okay.
So it wasn't that bad. I got 4.5 hours sleep, and I'm here.
Yeah, I didn't get that much more, but not watching at Green Day.
Green Day was great.
I was seeing a concert called Tug Your Prick Into Your Own Belly Button.
Well, yeah. You're not taking advantage of the hours. You think you've just got an extra hour to edge.
Yeah, that's all it is. I was home at the same time just fucking jerking. Oh, it's 12. I don't have to come till 12:40. I was watching Narcos. So good.
I've been trying to get used to the hours, but I haven't even sort of yet. Because I spent the last year going to bed at 4:30 in the morning.
Yeah.
But the worst part, I think, is the commute in. Because it's late enough that people who work are on the train,
sure.
You know, because I take the train in from Westchester.
Ooh.
And everybody's got their, it's just dozens, if not, probably not hundreds, but dozens of people who have their little train rituals.
And what's the train ritual?
They're all going to work, and they go to the train station, and they pack in these, like, clusters of people where they think the door is going to be when the train stops at the station. So everybody just kind of stands there and lines up, and then they get on the train, and everybody's pushing, and everybody's trying to get on first, and everybody's got their little tricks, and it's all just so, like, we're just lining up and doing this, and you can see they've been doing it for years.
I'll tell you, it's going to be a bad when you're starting to commute and you're like, these motherfuckers, they're just lining up to get on the train.
Yeah.
It's going to be an irritating commute for you.
Every morning. And then, I was so irritated yesterday because I was in such a good groove of living this schedule where I didn't see a lot of people.
Right.
You know what I mean? It was perfect. Yesterday, I was home now at 6 o'clock in the evening. Usually, I'm either coming in or here by then. So I'm home, like, when people are getting home, and I walk the dog, and, like, everybody in the building is just around. They're in the elevator. They're asking questions. They're in the hall. Oh, how's Lila doing? It's the dog's name.
Right.
And I'm like, I had this great run of not having to have any of these conversations with any of you.
Yeah.
And now it's like... Everybody, plus they all kind of know what I do in the building, so they've all got questions about the exciting radio man.
Ugh.
And it's the worst.
Well, good. Welcome to the hustle and bustle that we all deal with.
Mr. Norton. What's going on? What's welcome.
How are you, man?
Hey, Sully. What's going on, dude?
What's up? How's it going?
Sam.
How's it going?
Good, man. How you doing?
Over here. Perfect. Over there?
Yeah, over there.
To the left.
Yeah, we didn't know that you had such limited time.
In the box to the left.
You coming in singing Beyonce?
I don't. Is that Beyonce?
That's Beyonce.
Oh no. Oh, sorry.
I didn't even know that because I just remember a friend of mine that lived in Santa Monica. She was having this party one night, and it was like really late, and one of her gay friends climbed through like the little dog door that, you know what I mean, they have on the doors, a little swing dog door. And he just came in, and they were all, like, in the line doing that song, and that's how I remember it. I don't even know who sings it.
Yeah.
So. It's Beyonce. Oh, it's Beyonce.
No, I didn't know that either.
I love it, though. You should do a cover or something of it.
Maybe.
Maybe.
Never know.
Did you ever cover a song? Or no?
What, Beyonce song?
No, but would you? Like, would you? Not necessarily her. But Marilyn Manson covered...
Sweet Dreams.
He
covered a couple, didn't he?
A couple of weird ones. Well, Sweet Dreams was another one. Did you think the song is about you? Didn't he cover that, too?
I don't know.
You're so vain. I think he might have.
Oh, he did cover You're So
later
Vain.
Later on, yeah.
Oh, yeah, weird. He covered some odd songs.
Yeah.
A weird one.
Would you ever cover something that's totally out of the, you know, what you've been doing?
What did we cover so far? Well, we did a few rock songs, so that's kind of normal. But we did, I don't know. No, I don't think we did anything weird yet.
Disturbed just did The Sounds of Silence, which actually it sounds kind of cool.
I heard about that. I haven't actually heard it yet. Is it good? Did you hear
it? Yeah, he did a really good job. It's weird to hear someone sing
Draymond.
Something. Yeah, belting out that song, which was not written for him.
Right.
He's like a large mini-me, isn't he?
Yeah. I don't know him. We've one on Twitter.
I like Dave. He's cool, man. We get along really good.
He seems intense.
Yeah, I don't know. He's got that thing about him, you know?
Yeah.
Did your musical taste at all change? Like, because you have your daughter's a teenager, right?
Yeah, she's going to be 15 soon.
Right, so you've got, like, teenage girl music in the house,
right?
Yeah,
my daughter's awesome, though, because she grew up around music. She grew up on a tour bus, you know? She grew up around Godsmack and rock music and all that backstage. But she has a really wide range of music, you know? She listens to everything.
Yeah.
You know? Of course, she's a girl, so she has her dance mixes and all that, but she loves, like, the 1975, and, you know, she loves rock, she loves all kinds of genres, you know?
Did that change you? Like, when you see, like... teenage girls at your shows now, are you like, put some clothes on? Like, what, you know what I mean?
All
like
of them now. That's the whole thing now with teenage girls. They wear the shorts with like a little cheek hanging out of the back, and you're like, all right.
There was a time when that was exciting,
though. Tuck your vagina back in and get back and clean your room.
I always tell them to put their clothes on in my shows because they're fat.
Who do you think you are leaving the house like that? Sounds like,
my fans and Jim's fans, same people.
So you got your second solo album coming out tomorrow, right?
Yeah.
I hate when we don't get to hear them. Yeah, but
you don't want to hear right now anyways. It's kind of it's one of those albums you want to listen to when you need a good cry.
Oh, really?
Is it?
Big tub of Ben and Jerry.
Is this a mellower
It's the good. Solo stuff. The solo stuff's always acoustic, pianos, cellos, like it's real, you know, cleaner production, things like that. It's not a hard rock record, you know.
That's good, though, if you can go out and do your own thing. This way the band can kind of do what's true to the band, and you can do what you want to do.
Yeah.
Well, you said there's just a quote from you in an interview you did the other day that you were like, you know, you need the band, you love having the band, but if you were handcuffed to them, you'd die.
Yeah, you feel, I mean, well, it's just because as I've grown, you know, things change in your life. I'm not the same young, angry dude that I was when I wrote Godsmack stuff back in the early, you know, the mid-90s or whatever it was. So, you know, things evolve, and now I'm a dad, and like, you know, your life just it shapes itself differently. So it's hard to always be authentic to that as well. And I think this is a good vehicle, although this is a mixture of all different things that have gone on in my life or whatever, but it gives me another outlet, you know, to kind of vent in that way and clear out some of that.
How do fans respond to that when you're like, because sometimes we get it like, it's doing stand up, they're like, you're not the guy you used to be. I'm like, well, no, I'm fucking 48.
Right.
Like, you know, like, yeah, of course you're not. I'd be crazy if I was the exact same person. As long as you're not selling out what you used to do and going that shit, as long as you still kind of stand by it.
Yeah, no, I like it still, and actually, but it's different for me now. Like when I get on stage with Godsmack, it's fun. It's like a big hard rock band. And it's pyro and it's rotating drum risers, and like it's, you know, it's just a good time. Where before it was this real aggression that I needed to get out, you know. Well, where now it's like more like let's
put on a show.
Tighten up, Francis.
You know? just enjoying it.
Yeah, but so the solo stuff, it's like it's the exact polar opposite. You know, it's the yin and the yang.
Were you worried about losing your fan base when you first when the first album came out, and you were like, this is so different?
No, and the reason why is because I don't write music, solo music especially, for critique or for reviews or for awards or for number one hits. Like, I do it because it's another side of me that I love. I'm a musician and I just like writing music, so a lot of times I don't even plan on writing a solo record. I'm just writing throughout the years, and sometimes this really beautiful song happens, but I go, that's not gonna going to quite fit right with Godsmack. So I tuck it away. And then when I have a collection of them, I do it. You know, I do a whole record of it. But I think the fans in general have always been prepared for it because Godsmack, since the beginning, has had songs like Voodoo and Serenity. And there's always been that those kind of textures.
That's probably my favorite Godsmack song, Voodoo.
Yeah. You know, so they've always kind of, you know, they've known about that side as well, you know. This stuff is just taking that vibe and going even deeper down the rabbit hole with it, you know.
Right.
And do you do live gigs?
Yeah, I'm just starting.
Did I sound like a non-performer when I said that you do live gigs?
Yeah.
You said shows. I know.
Are you gigging?
Yeah. So are you out standing in front of people performing your wares? Oh, shut up, Jim. I'm tired. Yeah, do you use smaller venues like this?
Yeah, this is more stripped down, intimate, acoustic vibe, evening with kind of thing, storytelling, blah, blah, blah. So it's theaters and, you know.
That's cool for fans, though. You get to see somebody who you've only seen in an arena in that setting in kind of a much more personal, mellower setting. That's kind of fun for a fan.
Well, that's what I would love. Like, if I get to see some of my favorite performers or whatever, it doesn't matter who it is. I love a wide variety of different performers from rock to whatever. And I heard you guys just had Metallica here two nights ago, right?
They were in town. Yeah, we didn't have them on the show, but they were in town.
No, that's what I mean. Yeah,
they were a small
venue, right? Yeah. Like, that's how you want to see Metallica.
Yeah, absolutely.
Something. You don't want to see something. I never want to go see Ozzy in a small venue. We're going to do Killing Me Softly. Oh, no.
A lot of you didn't know. I love this song. But
one of my favorite Kiss songs ever is they covered And Then She Kissed Me. They covered it on Love Gun. It was one of my favorite things ever. It was so out of there.
Cheesy way to fit in the fact that the word kiss is in the title of that song?
No, you know, I never thought of that. I hope you didn't just ruin that for me.
Yeah, that's why they did it.
But it's a great cover of the Crystals? That's it. Like, who would have thought Kiss would cover a Crystal song? I love when bands do that.
How is it working with your dad? Because I read about it. He's on the single playing horns.
Yeah.
And like, to me, something interesting that you said was that you saw him nervous when you performed with him.
Well, no, yeah, well, you could just, like, when I first asked him, he, the guy's the one responsible for getting me really into music in the first place, because it was me watching him when I was 3 years old in the basement with his jazz bands or whatever, and I would literally fall asleep, like, in the acoustic guitar cases watching them rehearse. So, you know, all these years later, it's circled back to, I happened to write this song, and I didn't write it for this reason. It just turned out to be this swanky, bluesy, jazzy kind of song that needed horns. It didn't need a lot of the stuff I do. It needs strings and things like that. It's more cinematic and orchestrated. But this one was like funky and it needed horns. And then so I'm assembling this horn section and it dawned on me, like, my dad's a trumpet player.
Right.
He has been his whole life. And so he's still that dude that goes through the streets of New England and plays at all the Italian feasts. He owns the Northeast Italian Band. So when they're walking around with the Saints and they pin the money up on it and, you know, there's the Italian band marching behind it, like, that's my dad.
Oh, wow.
Yeah.
Real Godfather 2 vibe.
Totally. Right? Yeah. Exactly that, yeah. And so he actually plays the Godfather theme with the little EPK that you've seen at the end.
Yeah, he looks
like De Niro. Like, my dad looks like De Niro, legit. And so it's pretty funny. But anyways, yeah, it was cool. It was a really great moment to, like, not only have my dad record on a record with me and have that immortalized, but to play a live show with him and all that, you know, I'll have that forever as a memory.
And when you're, like, performing with him or recording with him or whatever it is, obviously now he's a different person, right? Like, there's this moment, and I think everybody hits it. Like, I know that, like, when I first realized my dad was a person, not this sort of being that you looked up to as a kid, you go, like, oh, what the fuck? Like, when he's humanized.
So when you saw him peeking in with a hanger?
That wasn't the scenario. That's the only part I remember.
But
was there something like that for you?
Well, yeah, me and my dad didn't. I mean, he's no stranger to this conversation. We've, you know, we cleared our stuff up a long time ago, but there was a long stretch of time where we didn't really know each other that well because he wasn't a good dad when I was younger. But you get older and then you go, man, the dude was 23 years old when he had me. Like, how do you know how to even be a dad when you're 23, right?
Right.
And he came from a very, you know, kind of strict dad that, you know, taught by hitting. And so, you know, that's how he learned. It was by example. But, you know, then you get to a place where you kind of, like, you start you start finding yourself in your own bad patterns and stuff and having daddy issues or whatever it is. So you gotta, you know, you gotta kind of forgive that thing and move on. And so for me, that was right around 30 years old. We kind of started rehabilitating our relationship. And now we're really strong, you know, and now we have a really, really good relationship. He's a good guy, you know.
That's what they did back then. They just hit. I've told stories about soaping them out. They just fucking did it and it was normal. Oh, now yeah. If you see someone hitting a kid, it looks odd in public. You're like, ugh.
I know.
It looks a little weird.
I know.
But I also want to get my good crack once in a while.
I've offered to help. I'm like, not to be inappropriate.
Well, who was talking about that back in the day? It was a comedian actually doing a skit on this where like you would come home and like your whole neighborhood would hit you on the way home when you did something wrong, right?
Well, that's like when Mad Men
like
first came out.
Would, I heard what you did and it's not smashing you.
By Bill Cosby.
the first season of Mad Men, there was this great scene of like one of the little kids just misbehaving in the house and some stranger who was also in the house, it was like a party, just grabs him by the arm and slaps him in the face and says, "You don't do that." And the parent came up and he's like, "Oh, thank you. Yeah, he was out of control."
What show is that?
So Mad Men.
I remember my mother, someone had hit me, some adult, and it's a vague memory of my mother marching me over there. And I'd never seen my mother yell at another person, her standing outside the apartment yelling, like kind of screaming at the people. And I was just kind of standing there petrified. It was the first time I'd ever seen my mother have a bit of a meltdown. Mother was none too pleased.
So how do you like discipline your kid? Because there's a lot... I'm not asking you, Jim. Okay. there's a lot less hitting, but a lot more shitty kids, I feel like.
Well, yeah, you know, and it's a real, I don't know, it's tough. I mean, you know, for the most part, you know, when me and Skylar's mom split up back in, I think it was 2009, you know, Skylar's been with Jen most of the time because, although they only live about half hour, 45 minutes from me, so I see Skylar all the time, but... But majority of the time, she's there with Jen. So, like, Jen's pretty much the disciplinary, and I'm the cool dad that, like, you know, Skylar comes and sees on the weekends. And when she's not in school, we split our time and that kind of thing. So I don't deal with it as much as Jen does. But it is getting to that testing hormonal teenage stage where, right. Like, everything's an issue.
Right. Mm.
Boys,
yeah,
and boys.
Right now, and plus and now you actually have to watch her. Now, yeah,
it's all
yeah.
Boys, and I'm like, tuck in your cheek again, please. Volleyball practice. You don't have to undo your shirt so you can see your butt. And they do these things subliminally that they don't think you see.
Right.
You know.
But now you're starting to say things you probably never thought you'd say. Like, fuck that. Really, you don't dress like that.
Yeah. There's a lot more things than that.
Have you met your boyfriend yet, or no?
The,
are you
the
not
big reality
stage?
Slap was like, Dad, because she's in a mood one day, and then and she says. Listen, you just need to take me to CVS. I go, what do you need at CVS to send? And I'm thinking, she's like, it's just, and she's cramping, and I'm like, oh, no, this is really, are we there now? Here we go.
Like, I don't want to deal with this.
Big reality slap at me.
You should have seen how my dad felt when I asked him to take me. Where's your tattoo?
Oh, that's been gone since like 2003.
Has it really?
Jim.
Okay, I've seen you. No, I've seen you many times.
You just
since
don't
then.
Notice the little things anymore.
I've just literally noticed that was gone. If yeah. I've noticed it, I forgot.
I
wow.
Took that off a while ago.
Well, what made you take it off? You just got sick.
Because everyone else started doing it.
Taking it off.
Yeah.
Were they
I
really?
Felt like I was kind of unique back then, and then everyone. Started,
oh, they should, everyone started getting
tattooing
them.
Tattooing a star on their little cheek, and I'm like, yeah, I'm gone.
Was it something you got sick?
Actually, what happened was I was starting to really love and get into acting a little bit more, and I didn't want to be marked on the face, you know, so
that makes
little
sense.
By little I started cleaning things up, and this one obviously that's not going anywhere, but
oh wow,
is it painful?
I had them on my hands, arrows are gone,
How'd they get them off? They look good. I would never have noticed.
The hurricane kills.
It does, right?
Oh my god, it's not even close. People are like, oh, does it feel like getting a tattoo? I'm like, dude, it's a violent pain. I mean, I go, this is the way I would describe it. Imagine the world's largest elastic band snap you in the side of the ribs at 1,000 beats a second. Like, it's a nasty sting. It's just horrible.
So and how many times do you have to go in to get it done?
It depends, because the lasers are different depending on the color, the size of the tattoo, that kind of thing. So, like, when I first went in there, I sat down, and the guy does this quick consultation. He looks at, you know, what you want taken off. And then he goes, all right, I got good news, and I got bad news. And I'm like, all right, give me the good news. He goes, all right, so to take this one off your arm and your face and a couple off your hands, and I had a small one on my leg, he goes, the whole thing will take about 90 seconds to trace. And I'm like, oh, all right.
That's it?
what's the bad news? He goes, the doctor goes, it really fucking hurts. And I go, how bad can it be?
You 90 know? Seconds.
He goes, yeah, you look like you can handle pain. I go, all right. So he goes, let me just show you what the laser feels like. So he puts it on my leg, and they have like the pedals, like a tattoo artist does, where you step on it.
Mm-hmm.
So it looks like a drumstick, like a clear tube. And when they step on it, lasers shoot through the tube, and they hit your skin, and it passes through your skin. And when it reads ink, it blows it up. It literally sparks under your skin and smokes, and it's insane, right? So he just stepped on it real once, just click like that, and I go, holy fuck. Like, I'm like, I'm dizzy, I gotta lay down, and my eyebrows are sweating.
I'm amazed only 90 seconds, though. I would have thought this was like, when you go for laser hair removal, that's like a week.
And you go over and over and over.
I thought this was only 90 seconds.
Because they don't have to accurately trace every line. It's like it comes out in like bunches.
Because it recognizes the ink.
Yeah, it shoots out like the laser looks like BBs or something, right? It's like a little clump of BBs that's about the size of it. And it shoots out and they just kind of, you know, go over it real quick. And because you can only burn it once. That's what it does. It goes under. It literally blows up the ink. And then your body over weeks resorbs it and it slowly fades away. That's the.
So you don't know if they've gotten it all until weeks later when you see concept.
Like that was one there. You can see it's almost gone. I have one more treatment on this one. But you can see little spots left, right? But like that's what happened.
It looks like uneven tan or something. Like it doesn't look like a tattoo.
That was a skull with a top hat and all that stuff. It was as dark as this once.
Now, do you want to get new tattoos or are you just tired of them?
I was going to try to clean up my arms just so like if I was wearing short sleeves, you couldn't see anything. But there's no way because I have sleeves, you know.
Yes. Well, that's interesting. That's really why I never got one because I'm so indecisive. The one on the face must have been very fast. Like one quick shot
and
you're done.
Yeah, quick. And it was actually one of the least painful ones. The one on the leg, but it was, you know, the guy's sitting there and he goes, all right, you ready? So he starts grinding through it, you know? And I literally, I go, hold on a second. I took my shirt off and I twisted it and I was biting it. Because I was biting it so hard, I thought my teeth were going to crack. And, you know, I got the nurse behind me rubbing my back and, like, everybody felt sorry for me. And then when he's done, he goes, all right, you're done. He goes, you know, next time you come in, there's this cream you can put on. It totally numbs it. You won't feel a thing. I'm like,
oh. He told you after. Yeah.
Did you like doing it, or did you kind of feel like, oh shit, I'm growing up? Like, I thought
like doing what?
Yeah, the tattoo taken off.
No, not the painful part, but just the fact that it's gone now and we're doing something new. Or
well, I don't know. I mean, you know, it's one of those things that I started going like, why am I doing this? Because there's the whole other arm that's you can't take a piece off that big.
Oh, right. You can't.
You can get single. I mean, you can try. It's going to be a long time, a lot of work, a lot of pain.
Oh, they get the cream for it. Now you just throw it on there.
Yeah, but the thing is, it's like what is it called? Lidocaine or something like that. It's like for burn victims, right? So it has like that. If you put too big of an area on, like, you get hot arrhythmias and stuff.
Oh.
I'm not down with that.
Can't they knock you out, though? Can't they give you a little propofol or something and then do that?
Yeah, but it's...
I guess. He's only got a couple minutes, but perform a song before you go?
Do you feel up to it?
I like talking.
All right, we'll just talk.
Yeah, I mean...
We'll talk and then what we'll do
it's early. You know, I would normally, but, you know...
No, it's fine.
These songs are miserable and they're... I don't want to bum anybody out of work.
They're not the peppy morning jam. Yeah.
What we'll do is this. We'll talk for a few minutes and then when you go, when we eventually go to break or something, we'll play a tune.
Yeah,
we'll
play it. Yeah,
you just tell us which one to play. So the whole sleeve now, you're going to leave because it's just too much to take off.
You have to. I mean, you can't because you could really damage, like you could scar really bad. You'll look like Freddy Krueger.
Okay, so
that's another thing people got to be careful of. A lot of people want to do it quick and they want to get it done. You have to wait a couple of 2 or 3 months in between treatments. And some people they'll say like minimal 6 weeks, but then they'll go right in and they'll start hammering again. They'll put the laser up too high or something like that. And then they will literally burn like wrinkle skin burn.
So they end up with scars.
Because it's a third degree. Yeah. That's what they're giving you, a third degree burn, and then it heals. But the way they do it, it just happens to... It's, I don't know, it's pretty amazing, actually.
But it heals
and it doesn't scar if you do it the right way and find the right guy, but I've seen some bad ones, and I'm like, no.
It's the same thing as tattooing,
I guess. You don't have a tattoo anymore, but now you have this horrible-looking skin.
Right, I actually had a great tattoo, now it's a shitty scar. Like,
what was the something you almost got but said, no, I can't get that tattooed? Was there anything you can remember or no?
No.
You never had a crazy idea for a tattoo and just didn't do it?
No, I did a couple stupid things when I was younger, but I did them smart, stupid. And what I mean by that is, like, I had, when I was younger, like early 20s, I was dating some stripper named Brandy.
Of course.
That's really her name, right? She goes, I'll pay for your portion of your sleeve if you put my name on your arm. I go, okay. And me and my dad, two artists kind of winked at each other, and he put it in this like nice light pink, you know, so he could cover it really easy.
Right, right.
Right in the headband of a skull, you know, this Brandy 3Xs or something like that.
And how long after did you cover it up?
Immediately.
That's funny.
That's awesome. That's
the minute
awesome.
You're wiping your dick off as she's leaving. Get over here.
She paid for that portion and she was out, and then we just finished the tattoo.
Yeah, just put the bandana right over.
Yeah, I swear to God, dude, that's exactly... Oh, it's the wrong one. That's exactly what it is. It's a bandana. That's
what her name
was? A bandana went right over.
And it's so thin, too. It's so easy. Like, done. Done.
There's, Oh, I was going to tell a tattoo story. I don't remember it.
Oh.
I fucking...
Don't feel bad about it.
I just seen your boy the other night, Robert Kelly.
Oh, he's in Boston.
He was in Boston.
You saw him his gig?
Yeah.
He was great, right?
He's so good. Yeah,
Bob is a fucking... He's an animal on stage.
So good. He was funny. It was just rapid fire jokes. Like, couldn't even breathe at one point, so that was
Yeah, Bob usually... He's like... He literally just goes up... Da, da, pow! For a fucking... For an hour. He's a very, very solid comic. Terrible so person, good. But a very solid comic.
We should, we should promote the album. It's called Hometown Life. It's out tomorrow. You can, I'm sure you'll be able to get it pretty much everywhere, right?
Yeah, everywhere. But, thank you to iTunes now. We're in a digital world, so.
Yeah.
What's a song you'd recommend us playing?
Let's go with track 3, maybe. It's called Different Kind of Tears.
Okay. Do you want to just break and then come back, or what do you want to do, Sam?
Yeah, we'll take a break and come back. You can also, by the way, he's touring starting at the end of October and all through November. He's going all over the place. He'll be in New York, Atlanta, Pennsylvania, Chicago, Detroit, Albany. Go to SullyErna.com and you can get all the tour dates.
Sully, they don't have that one they're saying, which they only have a couple.
Oh,
online.
What do you have?
We have Hometown Life or Don't Comfort Me.
All right, let's go with Don't Comfort Me. That's a miserable song.
Cool. All right, so we'll play, we'll play the song, then we'll come right back after the song.
It's called Hometown Life. Is the album.
Hometown Life, and this is Don't Comfort Me. Thanks, Sully. How much fun was Sully? That was great. It was Don't Comfort Me was the name of the
Sully
song.
Sully was really great.
The album comes out tomorrow, and his website is SullyErna.com. Speaking of internet activity, Jim Norton, there was some discussion of you mainly, I guess you and I, but pretty much you on the Twitterverse this morning.
You know, it's funny. I'm really irritated. So let's address a couple of things.
Okay.
Because Opie would rather go by what people are saying on Twitter, which is a good way to do things when you've been broadcasting for all these years. Just listen to what people are saying. Clear one thing up. I never once said my stand-up was hurt by Opie himself. I said my draw was not what it used to be because the radio show I was on, which I was 50% of, people didn't listen to us. There was not as many listeners. And they weren't enjoying it. And it reminded them of what it used to be and what it no longer was. So,
and you're saying that not to blame Opie, but to say
no, I'm 50% of it.
Right.
Of course not.
Right.
I'm not an adult who blames other people for things I fail at.
Mm-hmm.
So if I'm not doing well, so to clear that up, of course I'm not blaming Opie Radio. I mean, that would be psychotic.
Right.
But the show I was on, which let's be real honest, a lot of our hardcore fans didn't enjoy. They didn't enjoy it.
Yeah.
I'm half of that. So that's what I attribute to part of it. I never said it's Opie's fault. I mean, I'm not a fucking mental patient to blame someone else for my own. But the reality is, if not as many people are listening to the radio show, and the ones that are not enjoying it the way they used to, the radio relationship you have with people, it's different. It's not like a regular, people get really invested in you. That's why they love you so much, or they get so angry at you, because there's a deeper level of investment. So we didn't have that anymore. There was not the same reaction from fans. There was not the same defense of us from fans. You know, it was a totally different thing because the show wasn't that good. We had great moments, but it just wasn't the same. So that was what hurt, not Opie Radio. And there was something else I had wanted to address, too. There was one other thing I wanted to address. I don't remember.
Well, he said that... That you were lying about the afternoons.
I'm not sure how to respond to that. Why would I make that up? Where would I get that from? He's the one who mentioned it to me. And then Tim Sabian was talking to me about it. I remember having these conversations. You were here at this time.
Yes. Yes. And I remember. And it wasn't a matter of Opie saying, we have to do the shows in the afternoon or I'm not doing it. But there was a conversation of Tim saying, Opie wants to do afternoons. Yeah. Aunt and Jim won't do it.
Yeah.
And I remember that. And I don't remember what was on the air and what was off the air anymore. Right. But I remember being in the room. It could have been before the show or it could have been on the air. For conversations. And it wasn't heated. It wasn't like Opie was fighting with you guys on it, but he was saying, you know, afternoons could be good, which I would associate as lobbying.
Lobbying for afternoons. He wanted to do them, and here's how you know he wanted to do them. And I'm not going to do this for an hour, addressing what somebody is saying on Twitter, because technically, you know, this is still the radio show contract. This is still his radio show.
Yes.
That he could be on if he wanted to.
I wasn't supposed to be here. I'm not even supposed to be here today.
No, Sam means in a much bigger sense. I said to Bob Eatman recently, Bob won't tell me. You know, Bob had a weird job trying to negotiate with me and Opie. And I almost fired him a couple of times because I'm like, I wanted the mornings. And I knew Opie wanted mornings. And that was it. We both knew the other person wanted it. It wasn't a secret.
But it's like if you're doing a morning show and you're splitting up a morning show, both people are probably going to want to do a morning show.
Yeah, because Opie's saying he was pushed out. Hey, pal, I said put me on another station. I didn't want to be on the same station. I'm like, just put me somewhere else. I didn't expect them to squeeze Opie out for me. Stop getting your fucking news from Twitter.
It's also like it's what we were saying yesterday, that this thing is designed so that it can be a move where everybody looks good, where all the fans kind of get what they want. You know what I mean? Where there's no pushing out because nobody took Opie's show away from him.
No. And it was never thought to me, especially with my low company self-esteem, that they were going to push Opie out for me. That's not what the thought was. The thought was, we don't want to work together anymore. It was a mutual thing. And I never once said I was a victim. We didn't want to work together. We weren't enjoying each other. Put me on another place. They didn't want to do that. Because they want us on the same thing. Okay, cool. Put us on the same thing. I've explained why I didn't want to do afternoons, why I'd have to miss a lot more. So that was a point of contention. But I didn't control what the company did. I said, well, this is what I wanted. And when I said to Bob Eatman, hey, man, Opie, a while ago was the one who wanted afternoons. And Bob's like, well, yeah, I asked him about that. But he said that was a different time and things were a long time ago. Okay, fine. Think maybe your opinion changed, but you did want them at one point.
Right.
That's 100%. Anthony remembers that. I remember that. And I don't even think Opie's lying right now. Like, I don't think he's being a liar. It's like, literally, I think that's the way he remembers it, and in which case I'm throwing my hands up.
Remembers it incorrectly?
It's totally wrong. And by the way, I never said that Opie had me taken out of the replays. I said he didn't want Uncle Paul in best ofs. That's what it was. He doesn't want Uncle Paul in best ofs. I never said he took my comedy out of the replays.
Mm-hmm.
So, you know, but he's getting his news from Twitter. So I'm looking at this feed and I'm like, ugh.
The other thing I think that you wanted to say something about was the tweet that Opie was not happy with the fact that you had signed your contract a week or two ago and he had to find out from his agent.
Well, we're not that close.
Oh.
Why would I call you? First of all, it's not a secret. I assume Bob told him. It was some big secret. I just signed it. And then they had an issue with something they redlined it. Bob said they sent it back. It was like something that they didn't like the wording of that they had put. It had nothing to do with money. And maybe I could have just said, fuck you, I signed it. But it wasn't that big an issue. I'm like, all right, let him reword it. I said, Bob, I kind of want it like this and just see if they want it. And it was fixed. You know, technically, so I re-signed it. Don and I went out to dinner, and I re-signed the contract.
Mm-hmm.
Did I have a case maybe where I would have put my foot down and said, no, maybe. But it wasn't that big a deal, so I was like, fix it. This way we're all happy. I'm not losing any money. It is what it is. But the fact that he's just getting his news from Twitter and feeling victimized and squeezed out. Look, man, and as far as me not calling you, no. Why would I call you? You know how I found out that my last show with Opie was happening last Thursday? I got an email. The last Opie and Jim show is this Thursday because Opie's taking off next week, meaning the week that we're in right now.
Mm-hmm.
That was how I found out. He didn't call me. He didn't say to me, hey, man, we're going to take this week off. I know we're both negotiating.
Because this week is still on your contract.
Of course it is.
Yeah.
It was the last Opie and Jim show is Thursday. And then I get the email that all of you get saying, I mean, I can't make it, family emergency. Okay. Hope I sent him a text, hope your family's okay. He sent me back one, thanks, Jimmy. And then I see photos of him holding a giant fish. I'm not saying he may have even had an emergency, but that's where we're at. So all this nonsense and fucking 13-year-old girl shit on Twitter, just listen to what I said.
It's
in all the years you've known me, I'm not saying I'm the most stable guy, but I've never blamed anyone else for something I fail at. And people aren't coming to see me the way they used to because of the radio show I'm on being a big part. I'm 50% of that. I'm half of the problem. We were not good together. It is what it is.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
It's not totally Opie's fault. I was half of it.
Right.
And then he says, and I'm just looking at this. Someone said, if I had, hey, would you be mad if Jim went with Anthony? And he said, if he had the integrity, that's what he'd have done 2 years ago.
What does that mean?
I don't know. But at least I didn't lie about defending him. You want to talk about integrity? You want to get nasty? I would suggest you just listen to the show instead of reacting on Twitter.
Yeah. I mean, it's a good suggestion, especially because yesterday
was not
mean. You
know what showed integrity? When your coworker and your friend is fired and you go on his show. And you don't lie to the fans and tell them, no, things were good. We're getting along. You know why people kind of, people dislike me through all of that. And they were angry at me through all of that. And they still are. But nobody thought I didn't love Anthony. Nobody thought that I was indifferent to my coworker getting fired. No one thought that. Because I called into his first show. And I went into his show as soon as I could. And I've gone on and I supported it. And I promoted it. I didn't think that he had to have a fucking a decaf, a Sanka with me before. So if you're going to tweet stuff about people having integrity, I'm telling you, I was not nasty yesterday. You know, because as far as I'm concerned, he still works here. And he's just take the deal. Unless the money's bad, unless it's horrible.
But if the money's bad, then that's...
Blame me for that.
That has nothing to do with you.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? That's not...
But I'm like, don't do this like you think that you're going to fucking, oh, you don't want me start. If you want to get nasty, get nasty. I have not so far, because again, it's kind of a pussy move to get nasty while I'm on the radio and he's still figuring things out. But stop getting your news from Twitter.
And as adults, there's no reason to get nasty right now. Nobody's done anything bad to anybody else.
You sit there on the air and tell me, well, we're not friends, which is okay. We are. I mean, he wasn't lying. We're not close. And then you wonder why I don't call you. And come on, man. Jesus, yeah. What are you doing?
Yeah.
So that's where we're at right now. I never said Opie took me out of replays. I said Uncle Paul, he would get mad if Uncle Paul was in best ofs. He would. He didn't like it. And I never said that he hurt my comedy career. He was a supporter. He would always help promote the gig and had nothing to do with him being duplicitous. It was the fact that people weren't enjoying the radio show.
You
That's a big
felt
part of it.
That the show wasn't working. I think you both made that clear on the air at different times.
Sure.
And the fact that the show wasn't working was the reason that your comedy money was down.
People, no, not the money, but less people wanted to come see me. Yeah.
Right, right.
Less people wanted to come see me because there were less people listening.
Right.
And look, there's people who just think I stink. That's obviously, that's always going to be happening in my career. But the fact is, when less people are listening, less people come to see you. Less people feel like I'm really enjoying what this guy's been doing lately. I'm really having fun listening to this guy and what he's been doing lately. But that's not.
And that's not said to blame anybody as much as it is to explain that you were ready to do a different show.
I have never once blamed anybody for one of my jokes bombing. Or for me saying something that wasn't funny, or for me not, never, you know, under any circumstances, no. So, again, I hate to have to re-explain something.
Yeah.
Because I'm dealing with someone who is literally responding on Twitter. But don't talk about integrity when it comes to Anthony. You really don't want to do that.
Right, right. We can take a couple calls, but we don't want to spend...
No, and I wasn't going to mention this today, but it's like, what do you want to do?
Yeah. We were kind of down with it, but then...
This victim shit about, like, we're sharks in the water. Brother, I said put me on another channel. I didn't say fuck Opie, squeeze Opie out.
Yeah.
We weren't going to work together. Oh, and as far as the 2 to 3 days a week thing, It absolutely was brought to my attention that he was trying to get me knocked down to 2 or 3 days a week. We had talked about me leaving, and I said yesterday, he did stop me in the hallway. And he goes, that's not what I was trying to do. Okay, never brought it up again. It was what he was trying to do. Just own up to it. You know, I didn't think he wanted me unemployed, but he didn't want me on that radio show with him. And that's fine. I didn't want to be on that radio show with him. So we separated.
Right, right. But it's like, it's frustrating because it could theoretically be far more amicable, right?
It's not even that nasty at this point.
Right.
These little things were annoying me.
Right.
I know he's frustrated and pissed off, and I get that. But it's like, listen to the show and respond to what I said. Respond to what I actually said. Instead of just being a child on Twitter. You notice that I'm not fucking attacking him on Twitter? Like, what do you think? I can't do that? Come on, man.
Yeah, I mean, the whole thing that we did yesterday, it's online. Like, everybody's heard it.
It's there.
So there's no reason to when firsthand information is so readily available, why the choice is made to get it secondhand, especially when there's questions to be asked, is like, it's all there.
Yeah.
It's all of it's there.
But I guess I have no integrity because I don't want to wait for someone again. I guess I should have waited. I guess you're supposed to just wait for another man to make a decision when you're not going to work together anymore. You're supposed to wait. I'm not supposed to go out and say, look, this is what I want to do. I'm supposed to wait.
Right.
Until the decision's been made. And then I'll take whatever's left over. I guess that's what I'm supposed to do.
And I don't think you ever had a conversation saying, I don't want to do that show anymore. Give me the show.
The bottom line was they sat me down and said, if you weren't working with Opie, what would you want to do? Because they knew we didn't want to work together.
Mm-hmm.
And I said, I would, man, we'd work with Sam. I'd love having Travis around. Like I mentioned you guys.
Mm-hmm.
I'm like, that's what I want to do. I said, just put me on another channel. I told Bob Eatman, get me on another channel. It was never they were going to squeeze Opie out for me. Put me on another channel. I'll go up against him. I don't care. I don't even care if he wins. I just want to have fun doing fucking radio.
That's it.
That's it.
That's what.
That's it.
It can be fun.
I would have been happy to do that.
It can be fun. I don't know. We'll just go to a couple. Scott in Illinois. What's up, Scott? Oh, sorry.
Hello, Scott.
Hey, what's going on? Hey, I wanted to tell Jim that as far as, you know, people not showing up for your shows, my brother and I could not be bigger ONA fans. And at one point, we were going to fly to Boston. I live in central Illinois. We were going to fly to Boston and make a weekend out of seeing you perform out there. And it just didn't end up working out. Well, you end up performing 2 hours for me in St. Louis. And I haven't listened to that show in so long. We were completely indifferent to it. And we didn't end up going.
Yeah, and that's part of it. But again, that is the tone of what. And again, this is aside from people who just don't like my stand-up. I'm not saying that everyone liked my stand-up and doesn't.
A lot of people really don't like.
Yeah, I know. There's probably a better way to phrase
like
that.
Like lots. But there's a ton of people it's in the stand-up community outside of it that just. I've heard it.
Yeah, no,
they don't
I understand.
Like it. They
I
hate
understand.
It. Hate
I know,
it.
I understand. Believe me, you think I don't know who Sammy R is on Twitter? But yeah, but like what that guy's saying. But to imply that that's blaming him. Like, come on, man. Is anybody? You ever know me to be that fucking mentally ill that I think it's Opie Hughes's fault that I don't think, of course not.
Right.
The show I was on was not resonating. And like the guy said, it's just that feeling that people have when they love the show so much, when that's gone because they didn't love the show. Opie did not love the show that we were doing. I did not love the show that we were doing.
You both love doing shows, not that one.
Exactly.
Right. Ron in Indianapolis.
Hey guys, how are you guys doing this morning?
Hello, Ron.
Good, Ron.
So I just had a question, and I guess I kind of had the same question back when Ant got fired, and maybe it's too simple of one, but I just kind of always wondered, like, why someone doesn't, like, just pick up the phone. And I'm not saying this towards, you know, Jim or Opie, anyone in particular, but, like, if one person, because I'm, like, reading Twitter right now, and Opie's saying, someone said something, he's like, please confirm this. And it's something that was said on the radio show. And,
sure.
I mean, yeah, he could go back and listen to the replay himself and confirm it rather than waiting for people to feed him information on Twitter. It's just silly.
Yeah. Why don't we pick up the phone?
Yeah, he's asking, why don't you guys just talk to each other?
Because what's there to say?
Right.
Like, it's not like, in this, here's my assumption. When we're going into this, they're going to keep me on board. And I assume they were keeping him. I knew which spot I wanted. I knew which spot he wanted. It was the same spot. My solution was put me on another channel. They didn't want to do that. My solution was put us at different times. Obviously, they're going to have to do that. But I didn't tell them, you have to give me more. It's not in my contract. I'm telling you, I'm not going to give you a whole bunch of contract stuff, but I couldn't get them to put that in the car. I would love to have, but they wouldn't.
Mm-hmm.
So he's delusional if he thinks that we just all conspire to squeeze him out. I'm not comfortable enough with serious management to walk down and tell them, you give me this or I'm walking. I told them what I wanted.
You didn't even think they were going to keep you. You just said.
I thought they were going to let me. I literally, Bob told me about that research they had done where we were equally important to the show. I was assuming that I was gone.
Right.
Because I knew he didn't want me around anymore, and I didn't want to be around.
Right, right, right.
I'm going to play victim in this. I'm going to victim in this. Two guys didn't get along after a while.
Yeah.
That's it.
And that's all that there is to it. And it's not even like this. It's like two guys didn't get along on the air. Like, you weren't having fun doing a show together.
Yeah.
So it's like at that point,
you get tired of your life being dictated by someone else, and you get tired of it. So I was not going to pick up the phone and see what he's doing. I don't care what he's doing. I mean, right. I assume he's doing something in the radio world. And I'm not saying I wish him the best in some, you know, but I don't want to see anything bad happen to the guy. Like, for what? I don't feel hateful towards him. But if he's going to start saying shit like, I should have had integrity 2 years ago, like, I would suggest do that on the air. Because I'm going to respond. If you want to be harsh and you want to try that fucking, you want to go?
Is this your Walter White speech? Tread lightly.
No, just I'm going to respond in kind. Just that's it. If you want to try to be nasty.
So you're saying feel free to set the pace.
Yeah. I have not been nasty. But if you want to talk about people having integrity, I suggest you really rethink that line of fucking conversation.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. I don't know. Let's, Andrew on Long Island.
Hey, how's it going, guys? Hey, I was a huge fan of you guys back in the day, but obviously we all know that the new show didn't work. But for me, what worked on the show, Jimmy, was when you and Anthony, you would say something. It was almost sort of behind the scenes. Anthony would pick up on it, and you guys would have a side conversation that just took over the show, and it just made me laugh so much. And I'm just afraid that, you know, without Anthony or somebody like that, it's going to be sort of the same thing as working with Opie. And I just hope it's not like a straight man and you. I just feel like there's got to be a third element in the mix. And I could be completely wrong with that, but that's just my feeling. And I just wanted to see, I guess you probably addressed this already, but there's no way Anthony can ever come back to Sirius. Is that a fact?
I never said there was no way he could ever come back to Sirius. I honestly don't know. I know that nobody has said anything negative about Anthony, and I know they know that we would love to at least get him on the phone. Like, they know that, and they haven't said, you can't do that. It's probably up for discussion. I don't know if he'd ever come back or if he'd even want to come back. But to address what you said about that, the guy raised a smart point. One of the things me and Ant would do, and this is where Opie got resentful instead of just realizing this is what was working on the show, is Ant's a good reactionary guy. I'm a reactionary guy. You know what I mean? Like, I'm not a guy who just sits down and fucking opens things up. Like, you know, I hate to say, like, we're spitball shooters, but that's kind of the way we do radio, is we fire out responses, and that's what Ant's a genius at. So we were doing that together, and Opie would get angry and feel like he wasn't being heard instead of realizing, like, this is kind of what works about, this is where a lot of the comedy in the show comes from, is two reactionary guys in the back of the classroom kind of acting up. Like, you know, do you know what I mean? Like,
right.
That was kind of what made the show work or helped it work. It wasn't, you're not being counted. You're not being heard, Opie. It wasn't about that. It was, this is what makes me funny. And that's what makes him funny. And together, instead of resenting your role as being like, hey, I'm kind of guiding this and I'm throwing out some funny lines too, he would resent it and get uncomfortable with it and feel left out of it. And so that's where so much of that shit started. But that guy makes a smart point. And look, maybe it won't be the same chemistry that you're used to, obviously, but this is a totally new thing. You know, Sam and I have better chemistry than Opie and I, but me and Opie were coming out of a broken three-way marriage. So maybe that's why, too.
Right, right, right. And by the way, like, again, we haven't, I don't know what we're doing yet. We'll probably know what we're doing within a couple of days.
I think.
Just a couple things need to either get signed or not get signed. But I don't foresee that being a problem between you and I. If
no.
That is the word.
Because we don't have any, you know, I guess Anthony said on his show the other day that me and Opie had, there was always a weird tension. And I don't know why Opie doesn't see it. Like, you know, I've ruined every relationship I've ever had, dating-wise.
On purpose?
You know, I don't know. It's a good question. But I am bad. I'm a bad boyfriend.
Right.
I'm a great friend or a good friend, but I'm a bad boyfriend.
Yeah, good.
All right, yeah, I amended it.
Yeah.
I saw your stupid, I saw your dumb shoulders pipe up. I said, all right, good. But
so you've destroyed all your relationships.
I have been the problem in most of my dating relationships. I've been the problem. My addictive behavior, my selfishness. How does he not see that in this particular case, what he has done to make this where it is? Like, that's all I'm saying.
And before that gets taken out of context, you're not saying this is all his fault. You're saying he plays a part the same way you play a part.
The fact that he isn't signed is his fault.
Yes.
Of course. But the fact that the show didn't work between Opie and Jim Norton is a 50% thing.
Right.
Jim Norton's 50 fucking percent of that. I've never once said that another person, again, creatively ruined something I did. We didn't work well together, and I think he stepped on jokes and whatever. Maybe I think that was done partially out of anger. I could be wrong. But I never said that anything in my life was, oh, Opie ruined that for me. Who the fuck has given more credit to Opie and Anthony as people than I have? Who's publicly said more thank yous to Opie and Anthony than I have? Jesus Christ.
Right. John, in New York, you're on with us.
Good morning, you douches.
Hi, John.
Good morning, John.
albeit it was pretty hypocritical for Opie to write the integrity statement on Twitter. However, there is some truth to that statement. Didn't you admit to the fact that it was due to money and lack of audience as to why you didn't sign with Anthony 2 years ago?
I said the fact that they could not get the same kind of an audience that we could get here, yes. And Sirius offered me more money than Anthony could offer me. Yeah, but how is that an integrity issue?
Right.
I'm not complaining about that. Like, do you know what I'm saying? Like, they said if him and Ant got together, would that bother you? And he said, if I hadn't any integrity, I'm not sniveling. I didn't get back with Ant. You know what I mean? Like, he's making a point that I didn't make.
That's where it becomes an integrity issue is if you 2 years ago signed strictly for the money, knowing that you would not be able to do a good show, then it's an integrity issue, maybe.
Right, but that's not what I'm saying.
But that's not what you did.
Yeah, no, dude, no, not at all. I'm not complaining about that.
Let me go.
Oh, is that guy still here? He can
no,
respond.
No, no,
oh,
gone.
Yeah, let them respond.
Okay. Frank in Boston.
Hey, guys, how are you?
Hi, Frank.
Have you guys seen the movie This Boy's Life with De Niro?
Yes, I have, and DiCaprio and fucking Ellen Barkin.
Oh, okay, so...
Is there mustard left in that jar? Yeah.
So I see this as Sam as the young Ellen Barkin, Jimmy as the young Leonardo, and Opie sitting there crying on the porch, what about me while you guys are skipping up the street?
I don't know what you're talking about. But
don't you remember the end of the movie where Ellen and DiCaprio left and Dwight's sitting there crying, what about me? I think if you played it, you would see exactly.
Oh, okay. Yeah. I vaguely remember that. Look, man.
And it's like, but Opie wasn't having a good time with Jim.
We weren't enjoying each other. And that's the truth. He literally said that like, on one of the early shows. Me and I had great chemistry. Me and Jimmy, not so much. Like, but he was not wrong.
It's not the best way to position yourself.
And then he fucking, and then that one time with the Esther Koo argument, we're not that close. Not that close.
Right.
Like, you didn't say that to me off the air.
I don't know why they called her Barkin. She's not a dog.
Fuck yeah. She should have been Ellen Meowing. Go ahead. Elbow to the ribs, you piece of G.
Piece of G?
So, you know,
Why would you have to censor garbage?
I don't want to sit here and motherfuck. I'm not going to sit here and motherfuck Opie while he's not on the air. I'm really not. He's pissed off. He's negotiating. I get it. But just, I hope he listens to this.
Yes.
And yesterday, stop getting your news from Twitter. We don't communicate. You know that. I'm not motherfucking you. I will if you motherfuck me. And I'd prefer not to do that. And not even to be diplomatic. The company hasn't said don't do it. But it's like, ugh. I don't want to bash a guy that I've known for all those years. You know what I mean? I really don't. If it happens, it happens. I'll do it.
Yeah.
If he bashes me.
Yeah. Yeah. Steve and Charlotte.
Yes.
Hey guys, good morning. Question for you. Do you think Anthony is playing the Jennifer Aniston part and sitting back and just smirking, saying, "I told you so"? This is Brad and Angelina all over again.
I don't know if he's saying "I told you so." I mean, Ant's been pretty vocal about his relationship with Ope. I've been pretty up front about my friendship with Anthony and my feelings about Anthony. I've never hidden that. You know what I mean? If I had no integrity, I could see if I was saying, "Man, I'm glad you got rid of Ant. Fuck him." Like, if I never
that
said
is,
that.
Yeah.
That's a lack of integrity. But yeah. On the air. And by the way, this is not knowing your part in things. And this is a small example. Like, Ope had told us, one time, but with the whole Howard thing where he was fucking with him in the hallways, he would come in and say, "I was making, you know, I was saying hi to Howard, I'm goofing, I'm making it obnoxious, and blah, blah, blah." And then I go, you know, whatever, but I said, and then all of a sudden Howard bans people from the hallway. And Ope goes, "Well, I don't know why they would do that. Who the fuck cares about Howard Stern?" And on the air, I had to say, "Dude, you're the one who was doing that. You said you were fucking with him." He's like, "Oh, I was..." But I'm like, you said one thing and then a total opposite thing, and you said both of them on the radio.
Right.
Like, yeah. How do you forget what you said? So that's an example right there, that glaring. And maybe he was playing the first one up for the air. That's what he said. Okay. But then all of a sudden he came back last week and he goes, "Howard's, I'm definitely the reason Howard is having people banned from the hallways. Do you remember he said that on the air? I'm the reason he's..." What's the truth?
Right. Sean in Pittsburgh.
Yeah, I want to say a couple things. Obviously, the show wasn't working. A couple things that I want to say is, Jimmy, didn't you go on the Stern show? Now, you may have had O&A's blessing, or they may have said go, but didn't you go on the Stern show right after the show went off the air? And knowing that, you know, all Stern tried to do to ruin you guys, you just kind of ran over there. Is that some kind of integrity issue there?
Sir, I've never been on Howard. I am laughing.
A lot to do with you guys.
Sir, I am laughing.
He's right. He's right, Jim.
Stern right after the show was off the air.
Sir, I've never been on Howard's show.
So why'd you go then?
Stern show.
I've never been on Howard's show, sir.
Oh, okay, then I'm mistaken, and I apologize.
I accept your apology.
I thought for sure you did.
Never.
I thought for sure. I'm pretty sure you did, actually.
Okay, well, you
but
be sure
you
that.
If you didn't, that's fine.
You be as sure that as your little heart desires. I actually hadn't met Howard until we were in the hallways here. The first time I ever met, I might have said hi to Howard once at a serious event, at the McCartney event. I think we said hello. But the first time he and I actually, like, stopped and talked for a second was me and Opie were actually in the lobby, and Opie was sitting at the table, and Howard walked by, and I said, "Hey, how are you?"
I was wrong.
No, I know you were. I didn't know you were still on the phone.
I don't know. I think Sean may have, Sean, I think you may have a point on this one, actually.
And you know, it's funny. One of the things with Howard is I even said, not only did I never go on Stern, and he never asked me to come on. It wasn't like he asked me and I said no, but I never even tried when we were off the air. The only enemy of the show, quote unquote, whose show I went on that I can remember was Lex and Terry, we had fought with, and they were in Dallas, and they reached out to me, and it was a long time after the fight, and they said, "Would you like to come on?" And I said, "Yeah, as long as we can talk about what happened." And they're like, "Yeah, sure." Like, they're like real radio guys. They were happy to talk about it, and we did, and we got along fine. So,
okay. What I want to say, Jim, please let me. I understand. I was wrong, and I apologize.
Well,
okay.
that's still out for the jury to decide, quite frankly.
Yes. Okay, but
no,
what
I
else
was
it?
Sure, you did.
I'm going to do a little research myself
on
that.
Yeah, please do.
Please.
What I thought was why the show didn't work was a couple of things. One, for some reason, you guys wanted to take it to an area. Now, whose decision this was, maybe it was everyone. Take it to an area of always having comedians in, always having interviews, always having guests. And the best part of what your show used to be was just you guys riffing. And, you know, we don't want it to be intellectual, knocked over the head all the time. You know, I don't want UFC guys in all the time. I don't want you know, to hear.
Well, hold on. One point at a time.
You were doing too much intellectual stuff with UFC fighters. It was too much.
Well, the UFC fighters this week is because they're in town. It happens to be a giant press conference. But I understand some guys don't like the fighters, and I get that. As far as the guests are concerned, I'm answering your question.
Sean sucks.
I'm answering your question, Sean. Jesus Christ, Howard never would have did this when I was on his show. No, and as far as the comedians, after a point, dude, I didn't book like guys like Chris and Sherrod and Vic, and I'm only naming them because they were the regulars. I would never know when they were coming in, or Mark. They would just be in. Opie had that with Roland taken care of. I was very rarely consulted on that, but I liked the guests that were coming in, a lot of the guests. So that was both Opie and I, but the daily comedians that were in was him. But I would just kind of come in and see someone sitting here and, oh, that's who's in for the day. But that became more because we weren't enjoying each other. And again, it wasn't a visceral hatred. It wasn't as fun for us. So does that answer your question a little bit, Sean?
Yeah, I think you two can work good together. But Sam, I got to tell you, your night show is the best show I've ever heard. And I hate to see that go away. It gives me something to do at night, and I'm going to miss it. But I think you two, if you can not have guests in every day, and you two just go back and forth. And Jim, I love you guys. But another thing is, I feel like a lot of times maybe you have too much coffee that you just dominate the conversation and you'll just throw stuff in. I mean, your little play on words gets old after a while. Your characters that are in your head get old after a while.
Fuck yeah, I hear what you're saying. Howard told them the same thing.
Well, there's a lot of people that don't like it.
Fuck yeah, I'm sure there are. Robin didn't like it. Jackie the Jokeman.
Jokeman.
So there's a lot of people that don't like a lot of things I do. There's not a lot of good shows on the radio.
That's right. You probably know.
Yes,
and
we do know shows.
All you got to do, Jim, is just sit back and maybe let somebody else talk once in a while.
I'm not sure what you mean about me dominating the comments. Sam is a pretty verbose young man, and Opie was pretty comfortable talking. I'm not sure what you mean, but I can't change the fact that I'm talking on with Norton and friends with my pal Sam.
Sean, I
appreciate my preference. My preference as we move forward is, Jim, that you continue to talk at the same amount.
Thank you, Sam.
That you've been talking.
All right, Sean, we gave you as much time. You've listed a lot of things you didn't like. I tried to address them.
Right.
You started off really on the wrong foot.
Play on words.
What's that?
Play on words is just stupid.
How about if I play on a field or something?
Well, you think that's funny?
Fuck, I know it's funny. I know it's funny. Piece of garbage.
It's really annoying. Actually.
Yeah. You ought to see the
How
happy
about doing
faces.
It maybe a couple times a day. A couple? Can we do maybe a couple times
no,
a day?
No, we can't be a couple. What are you trying to suck my pecker? What are you trying to suck my fucking pecker, Sean?
Do you understand that I would pay good money to watch a live road show just between Sean and Chip? Like, Sean is the perfect audience for Chip.
Yeah. Fuck yeah. He knows what he's talking about.
That's not funny. Yeah, it is.
Hey, Jim, weren't you on the fucking, whatever the show is, the Bill Stern show?
Howard is his name.
What else you got?
Research it. Research it there, Sam.
I'm fucking leveling this cocksucker.
Sean, is there any other complaints while we have Chip in here?
No, just take what I say, because a lot of us fans feel this way.
No,
just
I don't disagree.
Oh, no.
No, I don't disagree, Sean. No. I think you're right. It's too much negativity. Awesome sauce. You don't like that?
Awesome.
Oh, I have a couple more things if you want them.
Okay.
You got to say one positive first.
Yes.
A positive is Jim is an amazing comedian. But what I don't like.
No. You can't not let me thank you before you go on to the night. You can't say I'm an amazing comedian. You have to let me breathe and enjoy that and go, thank you, Sean. Now you can continue.
Okay. You're welcome, Jim. But the fanboy of you is another annoying thing.
What?
It seems like we have guests in just so you can get a picture, so you can get their autograph.
Yeah, there's been times where I'm too much of a fanboy. Here's the good and bad is this. There are times when I'm too much of a fanboy. People have always said to me when they've met me that I'm nice to them when they meet me, and I'm always try to be very, very respectful and courteous to fans when I meet them. Part of that is because I know what it's like to be a fan of someone else and not be treated well. So it kind of works both ways. But yeah, maybe I've done that too much. Fair enough.
All right. Let's just have a great whatever it's going to be. Let's just move on and, you know.
Sean, are you looking for a gig?
I'll never stop listening.
I'll
never stop listening. There's two shows, you and the Stern. There's nothing else any good on this whole series except for sports. There's nothing else. Everything else is stupid. Let's just move on, and hopefully we can, you know, pick up where we left off the good old days. So thank you guys for taking my call. It's very brave of you.
Thank you, Sean. I appreciate it. Yeah, super brave.
I didn't think it was really scary.
I kind of want to hire Sean as the new executive producer of the show.
Yeah, Jim, stop doing the thing with the characters.
Yeah. Jim, what is this I hear? Right after the show on Thursday, you went and did Howard's show?
No, Sean.
Okay. All right.
I might be wrong, but I still think you're wrong.
Okay, but I think you did.
It's so funny.
All right, we should take a break. We don't know what the name of the channel is going to be. Right now, it's Opie Radio. Hopefully, it'll stay. Who cares? Opie Radio is fine. Hopefully, Opie will. I hope he signs. I would rather him be here in the afternoons than not be here.
It's up to him. I assumed he was signing all along.
Yeah. And for those of you calling in about the night show, I'll be on tonight at 9, tonight and tomorrow at 9 p.m. Eastern here, so we can talk about it then. All right, we're going to take a break. Have you been keeping up with...
I thought you were going to say working out because I just stressed.
Yeah, no, I wasn't going to say that.
Yes, I have been.
Have you been keeping up with Gary Johnson?
No.
He is a horse's patoot.
Is he really?
Oh, yeah, he is. Yeah, he is. We'll talk about... what Gary Johnson said. Was that at the a debate last night?
Did Gary Johnson mention my eggs?
Oh, it's just, why would Gary mention your eggs?
I don't know.
Oh, because you don't have them?
No, I don't. Where's the little guy? Is he out?
We getting Jim some eggs or what?
Is he out?
Yeah, he's out.
Oh, okay.
Yeah.
Egg diva.
I'm hungry. My stomach is growling.
We'll talk about Gary Johnson at his MSNBC interview and a whole lot more after this. Jim Norton, Sam Roberts, you got your eggs. Eggy Wegs.
Yeah. And they bring me a fork and a knife. What's the knife for? Who cuts eggs? I mean, that's like a new thing I'm working on. Crazy stuff that you get from the diner.
A little observational humor.
Yeah, the knife.
It's just great.
I'm like cutting my avocado. What? You guys can hear that type of job. I'm doing NIAC, Levity Live, tonight, tomorrow, Saturday. That's just like one of many type of jokes I'm doing.
Many type of jokes.
You ever get eggs and you get your avocado? I threw a knife in there. I said to the guy, what am I going to cut my avocado? He laughed. He took the knife back.
It's great because it's relatable because you say avocado. So it's like you're just like an everyman, you know?
Yeah, regular dude. Man.
Exactly. Exactly. So Levity Live is tonight, tomorrow, and Saturday.
Yeah, and then I'm in D.C. next week. And I have a new venue to tape my special we're going to announce. I'm so happy.
Ooh.
Big boy's happy.
Levity Live is a good club. If you haven't been, you should go.
It's good food.
Good food. It's
good
fun.
Friends.
Yeah. And you can go to Target right after the show in case there's anything you want to pick up. Target? It's right outside the club.
All right. Two things.
Yeah.
I got it. Oh, Sam.
Oh,
why
man.
Why would it work?
What's wrong?
Nothing.
Oh. Is it That's not it, dude.
No, it's not. Who put that in there?
That's not the car crash. That's
It's not. What is that?
That's something totally different.
The original car crash I asked for. And hold on, Do a joke, Sam. That's good.
Yeah. Somebody leave the Flintstones on, or? That's not the.
No, it's not.
It's not funny.
It's not funny at all.
That sound isn't funny.
It's not at all funny. It's actual audio of a car crash. It's not funny.
Yeah. Paul misunderstood it. He went out on the street with his recorder and caused an accident. We'll get there. So, speaking of car wrecks, Gary Johnson. Have you heard? Did you hear about the Aleppo thing?
Yeah, I remember that, but I didn't kill Gary Johnson for that.
Why?
Because he didn't know what Aleppo was. I like the fact that he didn't know something and he asked. I was okay with that.
He's got to know what it is, though.
Yeah, you know, whatever. He didn't recognize the name of the city. So
but it's
what?
Not like it's just a random city. It's where, like, all the war is happening and all the battle. Plus, like, if there was ever a time for a third-party candidate to put their best foot forward,
that's true.
It's this election. For him to not know. So Aleppo is the whatever city in Syria where all the civil war and outbreak. You know the picture of that kid that's all like dusty and burned up and shit, and everybody's like, "This is what's going on in Syria." That was from Aleppo.
Yeah, but I didn't know Aleppo either. He's here in Syria. So
that's weird. So I guess, you know, being a comedian and the president is almost the same thing. Like, you should have the same
knowledge. You say that with irony.
It's really not that different. We're communicating.
Would you hate if I always tried to make salient points? Like, when you said that, I'm like, yeah, well, you look at the policies. They're jokes.
That's not even a salient point. Do you have the Aleppo? Oh, yeah, this is the Aleppo.
Stop saying Aleppo.
Well, I'll tell you, the one positive thing about it is a lot more people know what Aleppo is now.
Yeah. Do you think that they make jokes if somebody is in that town and they order Eggos?
What kind of joke would they make?
I don't know.
Just because it rhymes?
I'm in Aleppo, give my Eggo. I'm good.
Good thing we had some build-up before the car crash.
Joke bombed a half hour ago. Car crash stinks. I don't like the fucking iPad either. I have to gently touch her to the screen changes.
That's also like way far in front of you. Shouldn't it just be like right? You could just tap it?
I know. It used to just be, now it's hold on a second. All right, we have Wi-Fi. Yeah. Terrible.
Sorry, it's a weak signal area. We weren't able to get it. So this is Gary Johnson, like, from a few weeks ago. And MSNBC, that's where he makes all his blunders, huh? MSNBC is the bane of Gary Johnson's existence. So they asked him about Aleppo. And you know how I knew? I didn't know what Aleppo was, obviously. But I'm a moron, you know? I figured out that it was a big deal because of the way the host responded to him, which was really the most disrespectful way I've ever seen a host respond to a presidential candidate.
It was like a real, what you talking about, Willis?
It wasn't like that at all.
Oh. But it was.
Just a sitcom reference from the 70s. The kid on it is dead. That's how old that reference is. They're all dead.
Except for fucking Willis.
Yeah.
Todd Bridges.
Yeah. One of them tried to rob a fucking video rental store. Dana Plato?
Did she?
Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah. All right. Let's hear the Aleppo clip from a few weeks ago, just for context.
What would you do if you were elected about Aleppo?
About?
Aleppo.
And what is Aleppo?
You're kidding.
No.
That's my favorite thing that any news anchor has ever done, when he goes, "You're kidding." Because Gary Johnson, like, that's where all plausible deniability goes out the window. He goes, "I blanked on it." But he didn't blank on it because he rephrased he rephrased Aleppo in the question. Like, he didn't misunderstand. He didn't misplace the word. He re-said Aleppo as he said, "What is Aleppo?" Right? And then the guy on MSNBC that just goes, "You can't be serious." Like, I'd smack a man in the face for saying something like that to me. If I were running for president, really robs him of credibility. Go on.
Aleppo is in Syria. It's the epicenter of the refugee crisis.
Okay, got it. Got it.
Well, okay, got it. Got it. As if this is like an okay, like respectable, like, got it. Well, thanks for the information. Okay, understood. No problem. Oh, what? That's one of those things that I don't know how you recover from it, you know? Like, there's no decent excuse.
What do you think about Aleppo? Look, if somebody's overweight and they can't get rid of it, it's one of those things they have to do. Oh, I misunderstood.
Yeah, I didn't say hippo.
Oh, or lipo. Oh, no. What's Aleppo? It's a fun toy for children, and above.
And then he goes, like, because his excuse was, I thought it was like it meant something, like the letters stood for something. Not that it was, I didn't, you know, and then I remembered it was a city.
Yeah, he made a mistake. I don't kill him for that, though. Just a mistake. What am I doing?
He didn't know. It wasn't a mistake because he didn't have the information.
Meaning he just didn't know it. That's fine.
Well.
He didn't recognize that. If they said, what do you think about the problem in Syria? And he said, what problem? Then there'd be a problem.
Yeah, everything's fine. Well, I don't know what you're talking about. Then he went back on MSNBC last night.
Oh, good. I'm sure he strained it all out.
Yeah. And he had a town hall. It wasn't the same guy, right? No, this is now Hardball. Hardball was talking to him. Just give it straight.
What?
That's Aleppo. Hardball was asking all the tough questions last night.
And they had, later?
Yeah, yeah. They had Gary Johnson
who's
on.
My favorite?
Any, just name anyone on, in the any one of the continents. Any...
Who's on with him? Do we know?
No, Dewey's not on.
Yeah, do we know? So Gary Johnson was on doing a town hall, and this is what Hardball asked him.
Who's here? Serious?
No.
Good one.
There's 10 seconds of silence because you have to reach over and hit it, and then the thing lasts half an hour. Go on with the clip.
Who's your favorite foreign leader?
Who's my favorite?
Any, just name anywhere in the country, any one of the continents, any country. Name one foreign leader that you respect and look up to. Anybody.
Mine was Shimon Peres.
No, no, okay, I'm talking about living. Go ahead. You got to do this. Anywhere, any continent. Canada, Mexico, Europe over there, Asia, South America, Africa. Name a foreign leader that you respect.
I guess I'm having an Aleppo moment in the former president of Mexico.
But I'm giving you the whole world.
I know.
Anybody
I know.
In the world you like. Anybody. Pick any leader.
The former president of Mexico.
Which one?
I'm having a brain. I'm
well, name
brain
anybody.
Fox.
Fox. Okay, who's your favorite foreign leader? Get him off the hook. Name a foreign leader you respect.
He was terrific.
Any foreign leader?
Merkel.
Okay, Merkel. Okay, fine. Save yourself.
The other guy answered it real quick.
Wow, what a dope.
He couldn't name a foreign leader. You're telling me as much shit as Sarah Palin took for not being able to name what newspaper
right.
or whatever, he can't name one foreign leader.
So all you people who are saying vote for Gary Johnson, like, how do you explain this? Like, I don't know how you explain this.
Like, I see, okay, you let him off the hook for Aleppo.
I did.
But the fact that he doesn't know what Aleppo is, he also knows no foreign leaders, not one. He can't name a single foreign leader off the top of
people
his head.
People think Trump doesn't sound presidential. And I get why you say that, but do you think this guy sounds more presidential?
That's he'd be giving speeches like if his teleprompter went out at any moment. He's like, you know, we're having a lot of trouble with the country. They're doing they're doing well.
Which one to say his name? Aleppo was its name.
And Chris Matthews was really confident in that. Oh, I'm sorry, I didn't wait the minute.
Yeah. No, Travis, you were right. We would have been off subject by the time that car crash ended.
Yeah.
Chris Matthews, what?
He was so confident in the way that he said that. Like, he knew
one
that he wasn't
going to. Leader. Yeah, one.
He was probably like, watch this, I'm going to fuck him.
So you think that Chris Matthews.
Absolutely. The way that he was saying it, he's like, just go ahead, I dare you. Name one.
I bet what happened was. Chris Matthews was like, this is just a fun question. And then he's so, like seasoned at this that he saw the look in Gary Johnson's eyes and went, oh, my God. Like, he got excited. Like, he got so happy. He was like, oh, my God. The guy doesn't know any foreign leaders.
You know how dumb he would have looked in a debate with those guys?
Oh. And then he goes, whoever it is, the former president of Mexico, you know what I'm talking about. Like, you can't.
And he says which one, and he still can't name it.
Which one was it? I don't know, but he was terrific. He was great. He's like they say Trump sounds like, you know, your uncle or your grandfather.
Yes.
Like, even Gary Johnson is starting to, like, sound like my dad, who forgets people's names all the time. He's like, who's the... remember what's his name was saying to the like, you just don't know what they're talking about.
Yeah, just reaching and they have no idea what they're talking about. Yeah, I do know. Yeah.
Oh, we do have Drew in Baltimore, who's a Gary Johnson supporter.
Okay, hi Drew.
Drew, you there?
Yeah, I'm here. Hey guys.
Gary Drew, a blank. Yeah, Drewski.
Jim. Actually, we've done audience research, and wordplay humor does not go over well.
Do you like wordplay humor?
I do, especially when Chip does it.
All right, so we have 50-50 right now.
50-50. Okay, so far, it's Sean and the Gary Johnson supporter are duking it out.
Yes.
For tone of the show. All right, yes, sir. What's up?
For supreme idiocy.
No, actually, that I had never heard of Gary Johnson until that first Aleppo gag. And then I looked into him, and I realized that I actually agreed with his fiscally conservative and socially liberal views. And this one doesn't really bother me either. I think you guys think it's an easy question. I actually think it was kind of a hard question.
For a guy running for president?
Kind of dangerous, too. Well, what if you slip out and say, hey, Putin, or just the first guy that comes to your head?
Look,
then you shouldn't be president if you can't think of one foreign leader you like. How about the prime minister of England?
Yeah.
Whoever that is. Or Ireland.
But you never know what they're doing, and you don't want their supporters. And I think this also gets his name out there more.
Dude, there's no...
It gets his name out there as a total buffoon.
Like, yeah.
Yeah, true. But he needs to get it out there somewhere.
Hey, man, there's no such thing as bad publicity.
Yeah, there definitely is.
There definitely is.
I know you support Gary Johnson. There's no way to explain this away. It's horrible, it looks.
It's very bad.
Because, again, I'm not saying you have to know. If they would have said, like, all right, what's the capital of Trinidad, and he couldn't name it, I wouldn't fault him. Who's the president of Iceland? Okay. But if you can't think of one guy, like,
any
you should know who the leader of North Korea or South Korea is, or of China,
yes,
or of Britain.
Just say Canada. It's right there.
I know. Travis pointed at his own asshole.
And by the way, it got to the point where Chris Matthews was saying, just name any foreign leader, dude.
Yeah, the president of Mexico.
Yeah.
Name any of them. Yeah, he didn't know.
It was embarrassing. Absolutely.
He doesn't know who the president of Mexico is.
He's terrible, dude. I'm having an Aleppo moment. I mean, that was the true test.
One of the things that he's making a mistake on is he's actually answering questions he doesn't know. The other guys, when they don't know anything, they'll just answer completely different questions that wasn't even asked.
Look, here's what you do. You say, well, look, you know, there's a lot of foreign leaders we can trust. Putin, you really have to keep an eye on you. But so at least you've said the name of somebody.
A foreign leader.
He just sat there going, duh, 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 duh. And then he referenced his biggest gaffe on the political trail. He referenced Aleppo.
His foreign policy knowledge is probably pretty bad. That's the second one he's tripped on. Like the Aleppo one, I said no big deal. But you can't not be able to name. If I can name a foreign leader, you should be able to name a foreign leader.
Right, right. And a matter of fact,
I'm just repeating what I say while I eat pussy.
If I
I say that a lot.
You do?
Yes, the girls love it.
Start reciting those names.
Yeah.
I'm starting to wonder why Sam Roberts isn't running for president. Because that was a good answer. How you just explained how he should have answered.
Sam's not qualified to run for president.
You're right. It's just an age thing. But 2 years from now, I'll be 35.
Are you only 33?
I'm 33. I'm sorry. It's my appearance leads you to believe otherwise?
Yes.
It's not nice. It's not nice. But I will run for president. Yeah. I will.
When I was a boy, I didn't want to be president.
What did you want to be?
Just not a fag.
That's your...
I couldn't help it.
Don't like this anymore. Don't like this anymore.
Yes. Eat a lollipop. Eat a lollipop.
Yeah, you couldn't... There was just no satisfying your oral fixation. Let me go to... I don't want to go to that. Let me go to Brad in North Carolina. You're on with Jim Norton and Sam Roberts.
Hey guys, how's it going?
Hello.
I kind of like the new format. I don't know. I will see. We'll see how it goes. But I was a fan of the Opie and Jimmy show. But hey, I live in North Carolina, and it's always been like a red state. And so I was thinking about voting for Gary Johnson just to help, you know, the Libertarian Party in the future. And now it's like, it's looking like my vote actually counts. I have to. You know, I'm wondering if I vote for. You know, I don't know if I want Trump or Hillary.
Dude,
I understand.
I got to a point where I was like, it was right after Trump started threatening to take away people's press credentials. And I was like, that's like a basic constitutional, like freedom of the press is important. It's a basic constitutional right.
Well, wasn't he just saying press credentials for his events? He wasn't saying they couldn't be in the press.
Yeah, but that type of behavior would lead you to believe that he'd start picking and choosing who he wanted in the White House press room. It's just, to me, it was like the beginning of something that seemed dangerous. So I started going like, oh, well, you know what? Hillary is a disaster. Trump is a disaster. Let me take a look at who's running as third-party candidates. And you got one chick who's getting arrested because she's spray-painting bulldozers. Or there's a warrant out for her.
Who's that?
What's her name?
Jill Stein.
Yeah, Jill Stein.
Green Party.
That's too plain. Why is she spray painting bulldozers?
She went and she helped there were like Native Americans protesting their land being bulldozed.
Was she spray painting them yellow to be helpful? She wanted them to look shiny and new, and they plowed over all that land that was being wasted.
She was huffing the paint with them on the reservation. Oh. too topical. I don't know.
Anyway. Hang on, hang on. Here's the only problem. If we car crash listeners on the phone, their phone bill is going to go way up because they don't have the minutes to sit there and wait for the thing to finish.
Yeah. Listen to the replay if it happens.
Thank you, Brad.
Punching out.
I'll talk to you later, buddy.
Great job, guys.
All right.
Thanks. Yeah, but so she's over there. You know, there's a warrant out for her arrest in this place because she spray painted the blade of the bulldozer. And then Gary Johnson has no clue what's going on.
Yeah, he just doesn't.
He's got no idea. Lucas. Oh, wrong mouse.
Oh, yeah, lived on the second floor.
Lucas? What is that?
Hold on. Boy. Travis is pointing. Hold on.
It's going to take a while.
Is that what you're referencing?
Of course.
You thought that my Lucas joke bombed?
I mean, I don't think.
No. Yeah, I didn't even.
It wasn't a question.
No.
Jesus Christ. Everyone's acting very tefty this morning. Like, on the
you know, I'd love to say that's not a thing.
What a bunch of...
Oh, it is. It ain't going to get better. What?
Wait, you were just laughing.
Yeah, Lucas in Massachusetts.
Hey, so first I got to say, Sam, yeah. I'm proud of you. You're playing the professional broadcaster Highlander and going chopping heads off.
Right.
That's amazing, man.
Right, thank you.
But so Gary Johnson,
there
you know,
can be only one.
Is that Highlander?
Libertarianism, they're isolationist. So maybe he's just trying to say that, you know, all these other leaders don't matter to him, and he just cares about America.
He
right?
would have said that. No, that was a terrible way to put it. I get that, but he would have said that. Like, hey, I look.
Well, it's either that or. Maybe he just smoked too much weed before he went on the appearance.
I would imagine that Gary Johnson does partake quite a bit.
You think he gets high?
I think so. I think he does.
Have you ever seen him on Red Eye? I mean, yeah, come on.
Does he do Red Eye?
He used to, actually. He does Gutfeld's show now.
Oh,
I haven't seen him on Red Eye in a little while.
I want to do Red Eye with Gary Johnson.
We should get him in here. Yeah, Gary, how do you not know who was that German guy you didn't like? I didn't like Hitler.
That'd be great to go on Red Eye and just keep dropping references to, like, foreign leaders in Aleppo.
Yeah, did you not like fucking, Mr. Leaney? Was he a bad leader? How about Patton? Creep.
He wasn't going for isolationism.
No, he was not. He would have said that.
He would have said it really, like, I'm not focused on. He could have said anything. He could have said, I just don't focus on foreign leaders because we've got so much going on in our area. He could have said, I don't like this foreign leader. He could have said, but he didn't. He responded to Chris Matthews going, oh, well, I guess I'm having a bit of an Aleppo moment. Because he had no clue.
Yeah, that's like...
He panicked.
That's like Cosby being in an interview and doing something and go, oh, God, this must be another rape. shouldn't mention your fucking biggest fuck-up. Yeah.
Cos, it's not charming. We haven't gotten past it.
Jesus
Christ. Boy, I raped that one, huh? No, Cos...
Yeah, that's a little sleepy town. I must have drugged it.
Yeah. Oh, Bill, you did that. You can't
mention that.
You can't mention that right now. Okay, I'm going to... Oh, no, I'm not going to... See, a lot of people are calling in now. Thank God for this phone screener, because they've got bad jokes, and I don't want to hear them.
Oh, come on.
All right.
Oh, come on.
All right. Howard in Miami.
Whoa, thanks for letting me do your show. Wrong Howard. Sorry.
Hey, you're wrong guy. No, I think Gary Johnson was taken aback by the question. I think he thought they asked him, what are you going to do about the lesbos? Even the car crash was, like, so silent, you'd hardly hear it.
Yeah, it's too low, too.
Is it too low?
It is too low.
No, I like the fact...
The levels are really low, yeah.
I like the fact that it's... I like the fact that it peters at the end, too, with the glass tinkling out.
It's honestly, it's one of the worst sound effects in the history of the medium.
Yeah,
it's just... It's really bad.
Other than the garbage that goes into these mics every day.
Bad sounds all around. The other thing was Donald Trump. He has decided he was pressed on
announcing to the world at the debate that he does not pay federal income tax? You remember that? We were talking about that, even though we didn't necessarily agree on who won and who lost the debate.
Yeah.
We all could agree on the fact that Donald Trump announcing federal income tax is not for him. Was the wrong move entirely, right?
Yeah, Trumpmeister shouldn't have said that.
Who would you call him?
Trumpmeister.
Why'd you call him that?
It's a nickname's cool.
No, it's not. Who calls him that?
It's just a cool thing.
I can never tell if you're reaching for, like, your food or your eggs or the fucking iPad that's 10 feet away from
it's
you.
It's really long. You ever see Freddy Krueger in Nightmare on Elm Street when his arms got long in that dream? That's what I need. Freddy Krueger arms so I can just poke it.
Like the accordion arms?
Yeah.
Yeah, no. It's just all around. It's a hindrance.
Yeah, so far, the sound effect has been an abominable failure.
Right. We're gonna have to go back to the drawing board on it.
Yeah, the iPad.
It's terrible, isn't it?
Give me a fucking sound machine, a small sound machine, and put the buttons.
But yes, so he's talking about income tax and not paying it. He has gone back on that.
Okay.
And he's decided that all of us who saw that and said that, like, why would he announce he's not paying federal income tax? All of us.
We're wrong.
We were wrong. We misinterpreted what it was that the Donald was saying.
Okay.
I'm Hillary Clinton in the next debate, and I say to you what she said yesterday in North Carolina. Hey, if he's not going to pay any taxes and he thinks that's smart, what does that make us? We pay taxes. Are we stupid? How are you going to answer that?
Well, first of all, I never said I didn't pay taxes. She said, maybe you didn't pay taxes.
Right.
And I
it's
said, well, that would make me smart because tax is a big payment. But I think a lot of people say that's the kind of thinking that I want running this nation.
Okay. What?
No, it's not true. No.
I said if I didn't pay taxes, I would be smart because I wouldn't pay such a big payment.
Yeah, well, he got caught out. That's the lack of professional politician. He can't help himself just to say shit. Like, it's almost like he just fired out a comeback.
Right.
She's like, you didn't pay taxes. Yeah, well, I'm smart.
Yeah.
And that's the type of thing you say when you're arguing with two friends at a table.
Right.
Not in front of the nation.
Right. Because the other friend at the table would be like, did you just admit that he was right?
Yeah.
That was a terrible comeback.
Terrible.
Plus, I believe he used the phrase, because I'm smart. She said, hasn't paid federal income tax. Trump said, because I'm smart. Not, well, if that were true, I guess I'd be smart. He said, what you're saying is correct. That's what you would infer with the phrase, because I'm smart. That you're now giving a rationale as to why what she's saying is true. It would make me smart. And do you think, I would love to know, if people around this country are going around saying, you know what I really want in a president? Somebody who's figured out a way around that pesky federal income tax.
Yeah, that's not what we want in a leader.
We want somebody who's not paying into the country.
Yeah, we want a leader who's a billionaire to pay taxes on some level. Yes.
Yeah. We'd like somebody who has all this money and goes like, you know what? I'm going to contribute it to the country. Not like, oh, no, I haven't been given. If I haven't been given anything to the country, if... then I guess that would make me a great president.
Because he says things like, and this is where it's a big mistake. He's like, well, I'm just using the law. Well, so is everyone that gets off on a rape charge because it was an illegal search and seizure.
Right.
Or everyone who gets off on a murder charge or whatever. They're just using the law. But that's not the intent of the law, you goose.
Yeah, people don't want somebody that is technically doing the right thing. People want a leader that they can convince themselves is doing the right thing, like morally, right? That's why there's so much fucking talk of God and Christianity and whatnot.
Sure, in this room.
Exactly right.
We talk about it a lot.
That's the direction.
Especially from in there. You can't get enough Christianity talk out of that fucking little booth in there.
No, out of the teff box?
Oh, boy, you talk about Christianity talk. Every time a Jew's come up, it's a fucking, it's no. No mention of the Jews.
This is bad history.
The teff box, we're going to call it?
The teff box.
It's definitely a bad idea.
Why?
That's where it all goes down.
Yep. Comment from the teff box?
Yeah.
Oh, box of teft?
What do we got in there?
It's no, either... Sam told me not to chime in. So.
No, go ahead. I want to hear what the Teff Box has to say about all this.
Yeah, comment. We should do a segment on the show.
The Teff Box?
From the Teff Box.
Let's visit the Teff Box and see. Where's the Teff Box throwing their vote?
Tell us how we've got it wrong.
Now you're just farting.
Yes, I am.
Grow a couple of testicles and let us know what you think.
Trust me, I heard all of them.
Did you hear testicles?
Oh, God.
Are people letting this one go?
No. But people are really funny. There were some really, really, really good things on Twitter last night.
Like, what did I...
Nope, you didn't say anything.
Edgar is taking on chip personification.
I don't know what Edgar's doing.
It's not good.
I don't like when they mold themselves together.
Right, right, right. No, that's when we're in trouble.
Yeah.
Because then they're starting to build an army. Kevin in Louisiana.
Kev, welcome aboard.
Here's...
Hey, I think I'm a little late. I'm listening on my computer, so I may be a few minutes behind. But, Sam, you said something about Trump taking away press credentials.
Yeah.
Don't you think Hillary would be the one to take more of that away if she were elected?
Why?
Ooh, that's a good point.
I mean, why? The press is behind her. Don't get me wrong. But anyone who went against her.
No, I mean, because she doesn't have a history of doing it now. And did Bill Clinton take away press credentials?
Yes, he did, actually.
Did he?
Yep.
Whose?
From the Aleppo Times.
Oh, is that right? Is that right? Oh, that's right. I remember you bringing that up on Howard's show.
I don't want you reporting here.
Yeah, I don't think that Hillary has any history at all of bringing up... Look, I mean, I'm not a Hillary fan, but I don't think Hillary has any history of banning press from anything.
I guess what I'm saying is I understand Trump did it. It probably wasn't right. But if he knows they're in the pocket of Hillary, then... You know, to me, he should have done it if they're all working for her.
Yeah, I mean, you could say, but you can't.
Sir.
You can't.
No, you can't.
You can't fuck with the...
I don't think if he gets elected, that doesn't mean he's going to go and take everyone who disagrees with him.
That's what you have to do, right? You have to give him the benefit of a doubt. You have to say, okay, you know what? This doesn't set a great precedent, but I'll bet he won't do it if he gets in. And that's like...
I guess my point is I could see her doing it over him doing it.
Yeah, yeah. Well... She hasn't set the precedent, but thank you, Kevin.
Bye.
I'll talk to you later, buddy. You see the... Why'd you look around like...
I'm listening.
Oh. I said, did you see the... And Jim had this, like, surprised expression on his face, like, are we still doing this?
Yeah. No, I was just surprised somebody wants my opinion.
Ooh. I get to talk now?
Me? I don't want to talk too much. You know, I'm listening to that guy from Boston. I was dominating the conversation.
I've already got Don on getting his phone number so we can bring him in full time. He's just an idea guy. I liked him.
So what were you going to ask me?
If you saw that... Congress had put down Obama's veto. Do you see that they're all coming together over the lawsuit thing?
Sure, they should be. And that I think Obama's wrong about that, that they can't sue Saudi Arabia if they fuck him. What's he doing?
So Obama vetoed a 9/11 bill.
Yeah, V-I-T-O, by the way. He Italian did it. Hey, what are you doing over there voting?
How are you doing?
You didn't like that, Travis?
No, it's so unnecessary.
It's stupid.
Sam's trying to have a conversation.
Hold on. All right. Well, I'll listen. Oh. hold on. Hold on.
Wait.
Let it finish.
Cool. So
you're
going
to have
less.
The mop up and the trip to the hospital in that, too.
Obama vetoed a 9/11 bill that said that people could sue.
Yes.
Over what happened. Yeah, yeah, victims and things like that could sue foreign countries. Obama vetoed it, and he said that it was because, like, people assume that he was being sympathetic, right, to the people who are against us. He said it was because he didn't want to set this in motion, where this could lead to other countries suing us and blah, 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 blah. I think that's all horse shit.
Either way, I don't know or care why he did it. But if there's legitimately a reason to sue Saudi Arabia in a class action suit, then not only should they... Here's the problem with that. If they're found to be guilty and there's things that come out in international court or whatever it is, maybe then we can't be as close to allies as we used to be.
That's what I think.
Maybe that's what he's afraid of. That's just annoying.
I think he wants to make sure that we're still in good standings with Saudi Arabia. Which, look, maybe from a world perspective, we want to make sure we're in good standings with them. But... And Obama's done this before. Like, he has an inability to understand that the people need to see him being on their side on an emotional level. It was like when he was in Cuba, right?
Yeah.
And it was an important trip for him to go to Cuba and blah, blah, blah. But there was one of the big shootings happened. I don't remember which one, but one of the shootings happened while he was in Cuba. And he was at a baseball game. And it was like, could he have done anything? Like, if he flew home, would he have gotten anything done?
No, probably not. He probably has a phone there, cell, could have sent a text.
But the people, when there's a shooting like that, they want to see that the president is at least involved in something just to make people feel better.
Right.
That's one of your jobs as president, is just to make the people feel better. So the fact that he would take, like, international politics and prioritize that over 9/11 families.
Yeah, it's kind of silly.
It's stupid.
It's a bad decision. It looks bad.
Yeah, yeah. And you know it's bad, too, because Congress actually, like, the Democrats and the Republicans both vetoed it. Like, they came together. And the Senate. Yeah. Everybody came together.
It wasn't close. It was 97-1 in the Senate.
Oh. You think Obama's
the other one?
What, the House?
Who's the one? You said 97. Oh,
I don't know who the one is.
Just some guy who really likes Barack.
It's Obama.
Yeah.
Just open the door.
Yeah. Nay. I. Nay. And then he goes, who keeps saying nay? It was him. You got it right, Travis?
I got it.
Okay,
yeah.
Good.
I didn't get it. What was it?
It was a reference to a popular television show.
Yeah, it's cool. It was on in the last decade.
Right. It was after Different Strokes. So it was the Simpsons reference.
All right.
You ever seen The Simpsons?
I've seen moments.
You have?
Yeah.
Yeah. You like it?
I respect it.
You do.
I respect that. I have a lot of respect for South Park. I mean, brilliant shows.
And the longevity.
Yeah, they're funny.
Yeah, they are funny.
South Park was trolling the White House.
South Park has been good this season.
It was great last season. It's good this season.
Yeah.
It's incredible that they could still do that 20 years in.
Well, because they were smart enough to figure out that, like, they can't just keep doing self-contained stories that happen in South Park, that if they can figure out a way, because they figured out how to pump the episodes out, like, it takes, what, a week, 2 weeks max?
Yeah.
To do a full episode?
And sometimes, I mean, I think there's times where Comedy Central doesn't even have it until that night.
That's what they were saying, like, just to make sure that Comedy Central, well, number one, to make it as topical as possible, but number two, I think it started because they didn't want Comedy Central to be able to edit any of it.
Yes.
So they would deliver the episodes night of.
See, I always feel like whenever I do a project, that delivering it a week in advance is important. This way the network can chime in.
Well, you know why your opinion may not be valid?
Why?
You use so few projects. You know what I mean? Like, so little projects that you would have to deliver to a network.
Sorry, I had to lean in.
And you had to push it twice.
Yes, I did.
Right.
That's cool.
Your finger slipped off the...
It would actually be faster for me to take the elevator down and try to grab audio of a real car crash on my cell phone.
But they, like, because they figured out that being topical is the way to go, and they've been crushing.
No.
At being topical, like, what are they, 2 or 3 episodes in this season?
Yeah.
Yeah.
And, I mean, they did Colin Kaepernick in the first episode.
Yeah, yeah.
So it's like something happens in the next week they're talking about
exactly.
it.
Exactly. They were doing the flag thing while everybody was still talking about the flag thing and the national anthem and the whole deal. They also they're doing election stuff.
Yeah, and they're not just being topical, they're being brilliantly topical.
Yes, yes.
Like, it's not just like, oh, that's cool, they put Colin Kaepernick in.
Instead of doing... Hillary and Trump, they're doing turd sandwich and giant douche.
Yeah.
I was waving at the Bella twins.
Ugh. Yuck.
What do you mean, ugh? Is that an ugh of jealousy?
No, neither one of them are good looking.
Oh, you don't think so? You don't think so?
Well,
they were waving at me, weren't they?
No, they were waving you off.
No, they weren't. No, they weren't.
It's funny how waving at you and swatting at an insect is a very similar hand motion.
That's not true. Both of them were. Damn. You saw it.
The Bella twins.
Yeah.
Bella Lugosi?
No, not Bella Lugosi. Again, I could understand where you wouldn't get the Simpsons reference, but I had to jump in with the Bella Lugosi reference.
They're really hot. What do they do for wrestling?
One of them wrestles, one of them doesn't, but they have
a fucking hot.
They have a reality show.
Yeah, they have big feet.
You think so?
Uh-huh. Are they coming in?
I think so. I hope so. I don't know. I don't know. I think they're doing Sway Show. They're not booked, but we'll just try to...
Just get the fucking Bella twins in here.
Get these chicks in.
The fucking Bella twins in here, Travis.
Are they going in to do Sway Show?
They're just standing out there right now. But just, I think that's where they're going.
Yeah,
just
chilling.
Fucking Teft Box in there.
Yeah. I mean, let's get a view from the Teft Box.
Yeah, view from the Teft Box.
What are we seeing outside?
Yep.
Check it out. A view from the Teft Box.
Just see the Bella Twins.
You know?
Yeah. Well, Travis has a little curtain. He can just kind of peek through. They won't know.
Peek? Yeah.
No, I mean, they can see me, so they'll definitely know.
Pay no attention to that teft in the box.
They're going to come in here and be like, who was that creep peeking at us from the teft box?
Yeah, was that the teft box?
Was that teft himself? They don't know teft's a person. They think it's a thing. I don't, what is teft? I don't know. It's a foreign word
it's a
for
verb.
Shit.
Got to drop a teft.
We did that bit like 10 years ago.
Yeah, but it got, but it got kiboshed.
Yeah. Not with my last name.
Well, whose last name? Oh, Nagel. Oh, my God. Sorry, I didn't realize. Hold on. It's just... real momentum builder.
The amount of time it takes to get there... and the amount of time it takes to listen to it takes so much of the steam out of what we were doing. It takes everything. It's gone. Let me talk to Rick in Florida. Hey, Rick, you're on with Jim Norton and Sam Roberts.
Attaboy.
Yeah, I'm a little late to the game on this, but the Hillary Clinton, when you were talking about Hillary Clinton and not banning this, when she was a senator...
You know, Chip calls her Billary.
Fuck yeah, remember that? Billary. Hey, Monica, have a cigar.
Where are you going to put it?
Smoke some pot and didn't inhale. I fucking do. What's he playing the horn on Arsenio?
1992 references now. This is like before Bill was even president.
Yeah, fucking Billary.
Hey, Chip Clinton. Boxers or briefs?
Yep.
Okay. All right, Rick, what was it that...
he always lets you down.
He does, doesn't he?
I was just saying, you know, you were saying that Trump is going to be more banning the media if he's elected. But if you remember when Hillary Clinton was a senator of New York, her big issue was the fairness doctrine, which basically was she was attacking Fox News, saying that Fox News is a right-leaning organization.
You mean the vast right-wing conspiracy?
I understand.
Oh, yeah, but anyway, she wanted, that was one of her things, to get Rush Limbaugh off the air, to get Don Hannity off the radio, to get
Mike Savage, all those guys, The fairness doctrine was annoying. I remember that.
Yeah, Hillary Clinton.
That's a good point. I mean, that's more, number one, it didn't work.
It was because liberal talk, for some reason, has not had the same effect on people as conservative talk. Maybe because conservative talk is a little less speculative. I'm not saying it's more right, but maybe that's what it is.
Conservatives come across as angry, and like it's like entertaining to watch. There's something entertaining about, like, you know, you get all riled up. That's
I know
what they do. Exactly. They come at you and they let you know how it's supposed to be.
Yes, this is what's going on. And we're not getting answers out of the teft box.
He sits in there, he's tefting around all morning, and the answer is, I don't know.
Yeah.
We're trying to get a view from the teft box, but it's not coming through.
Hold on. That's not what you said last week. Get the Bella Twins in here. Teft, peek through the curtain.
You see how exciting that sounds? Whereas a more liberal talk show would be like, you know, the teft box, it's supposed to be for a certain purpose. It's not supposed to be used for views.
And it's not all-inclusive. There's only a privileged white male in the teft box.
Yeah.
Let me correct myself.
That's the first time.
A white thing in the teft box. Yeah.
The inability to acknowledge teft privilege has been seeping through this country for decades.
I mean, I wouldn't listen to either of those shows.
That's just me. The first one seemed exciting to me.
Sure did. It was fun.
But that's also, you know why you wouldn't listen to the second one? Because you have not yet come forward with your teft privilege.
That's true. I'm not woke.
You're not woke enough.
Woke.
You don't like woke?
I don't.
I have a feeling, though, Travis, you have done us a great disservice, because I guarantee you that at least one of those, that the word woke, I could tell the way Jim said, oh, no. The word woke has now been implanted into his brain. I know how the characters work. And one of those, it's going to be cycled into one of the characters. I don't know which one.
We don't know who yet.
I don't know.
Someone's going to be woke.
Yeah. And it might cycle. it might cycle through a couple of them.
and then it'll land on one of them.
You know, when I woke, I was woke too. I was having a dream that I was giving strawberries to people.
Not even the right usage. Woke. It's not. That's not.
I woke. I dreamt I was giving strawberries to people.
That's awoke.
I was walking through the street and they were saying, "Kirk, I'd love a strawberry." And I had some. Have some strawberries. Right. I'm like, "Do you like them?" And they're like, "These are awesome sauce." Oh, God.
I wish somebody made your brain into awesome sauce.
It is awesome sauce. Just leaking out fun thoughts.
Rick, I hope you're happy with what you started.
Oh, I'm sorry.
Thank you, buddy.
Did you say that or did I think it? All
right. I'll talk to you later. We should take a break.
Yeah, make love.
No, we'll just take the break, I think.
Oh, whatever.
We'll do some other...
Cock tease.
We'll do some other stuff, but I don't think we'll make love. Do you see the...
Probably.
Okay. Well, then I guess
wait,
did you see that?
What?
You see the guy who tried to kiss Kim Kardashian on the ass?
Yeah, I thought of that last night. Like, I mean, just doing that.
I realized she has security. Maybe not a great idea.
You
yet.
Can't get rapey with these women, man. You can't be touching these. You know, what the fuck is wrong with people? That's literally, he should have his fucking face punched for that.
Yeah, I'm sure he did multiple times. But,
what a creep.
We'll take a break and talk about a whole bunch of stuff after this. Jim Norton and Sam Roberts.
Yeah, we're going to work on a little few sound effects. Not today, but tomorrow.
What kind of sound effects?
Some joke bombs.
You don't want to use the car crash that you have?
Oh, yeah, then hold on. It's really funny. Joke bombs. Hold on.
You know what my favorite part about that is? It's that every time you do it, you can hear that you have to lean forward to do it because your chest hits the mic.
Yes, it does. So I have to hit it just right.
If you're really listening, you can tell how absolutely cumbersome of an operation it is.
It's awful. It's like cutting the blue wire or the red wire. There's a lot of maneuverability. It should just be push, done.
And we've seen that because you try to hit it and you just stopped it by mistake.
Yeah, I don't know what's going. Sam, we need to fix this.
Who?
Sam.
Again, you sound like Frodo Baggins. Where's who?
Where's our Messiah and Lord?
The Piss Lord?
Yeah.
You would never believe what's happened, and I don't know if this is... Yeah, is he coming? I don't know. Oh, he's here. I don't know if this is symptomatic of Jim being in a fun mood. I don't know if he's just in a good mood today. I don't know if he didn't get enough sleep. I don't know if he got too much sleep. I feel like health-wise, there may be something wrong with him. I'm worried about Jim very, very much because during the break, he said, maybe we should get Denny in for just a minute.
Yeah.
And I went, no. And he said, no, we should. I said, okay, but... Like Denny.
Dennis yes. Falcone knows I do love Dennis Falcone. Yeah.
We're friends.
We are friends.
Yeah.
But he does, I mean, you know
yes.
that he has a deep history of far preferring that you be out of the studio.
There was many times I liked Denny coming into studio. I just didn't want Denny to be overused right. as a crutch.
Right. All right. So we'll see you later.
I'm a one-trick pony, basically.
No, but you have a good idea for the show name, which I think is appropriate that you say it because yes. it's a good show.
By the way, we should also, while he's here... Without bringing it back to all the YouTube and Twitter stuff, when Opie posted the video of the Shark Tank, you know?
Yes.
Do you know what Denny did on Twitter?
I do.
Denny, tell me, first of all, you don't need water. You're going to be in here
Denny
for 2 minutes.
Denny,
you're
a professional.
Little
you're parched. Yes, a little parched.
What was
parched.
Your...
Parched. I said parched. I'm sorry.
When yeah, I, that's because he's bird-like.
When I first saw that, when I first saw the aquarium, I said, I've DJed a lot of weddings at aquariums. And I have.
No, I know you have, but
it's nice. It's fun.
I just wonder if, like, he was obviously, like... The video, like he was pouring out his soul a little bit in that video.
Calling Sam and I blood-sucking sharks.
Right. And it made me feel like maybe you weren't taking the video all that seriously.
Well, now I think it makes for good radio.
You do.
A lot of tension.
You like the tension.
Yeah, it's very warm in this studio. It must be all the love that's pouring out, right?
I guess so.
Very warm in here today.
I guess so.
Yeah. You want my name?
So tell me, you know, speaking of love. Mm-hmm. I'm advocating I don't think that the show needs a name. You know, I don't think it needs a goofy name. I know that Jim has spent far too much energy trying to come up with names
we earlier this week
they rejected fucking the main name. They whatever. They've rejected everything I've come to.
I like that. I like Norton and Friends.
I do too.
It puts his name out there.
My good natured one. Remember, top. I said Sam is a cunt, but I said we'll spell with a K, so it's cute.
I don't like that because that's what I said. I said Norton and Friends. That doesn't really give me a lot of credit. And Jim countered with, "Good, we'll do Sam is a cunt."
Okay, yeah. Norton and Friends. Yes, you're neither of those. I said, "How about all things Teft?"
And I seconded that, but that's when the Teftmeister put his foot down.
Yeah, and I don't think the company definitely wouldn't want that.
No, they didn't.
The Teftster.
Yeah. They said, "Who is he?"
I said, exactly.
Right.
I walked you in. Scott's like, "I've never seen this guy. Is he a badge?"
Right. Right. We rejected Morning Queens. What did you think of Morning Queens?
Yes, Denny's right.
That little polarizing.
Been, little polarizing.
Little polarizing.
Might have been better. Better on you.
What do you think? I believe. What was it? Morning Glances. Was that one of them?
That was fun. Yeah.
You like Morning Glances?
Fudging around with friends.
No. Norton and Fiends. You like that one?
Yeah, it's kind of like Friends, but Fiends implies that there's going to be some deviance.
Deviance. But I think the best one is we take the UFC logo, right?
Well, what do you think of the real quick, Danny?
Oh, okay.
One very popular one, and it was all put to vote.
Mm-hmm.
Horse Cock and Sam. What did you think of that one?
Well, I don't think we could get that repeated in the press too
right.
much. And you want to get press.
Hopefully.
Good press, bad press, press is press.
That's right.
You know, stuff like that.
That's
what
right.
about Morning Harambe? That was very topical.
Morning Harambe with a U.
Yes.
Right. Yeah.
That was a good name.
Yeah, but you know what? The Harambe will be out of the news.
Attaboy. Yeah, Danny's right. It won't be topical.
No, you're right.
Topical.
Right.
You want to stay topical.
You're right. No, you're right.
So what do you think?
I got my idea. I told Sammy before.
Well, what do you? So it's the UFC logo. That's the font
UFC,
we're thinking.
The font.
But it's not UFC.
No. Yeah. It would be MFC.
MFC.
Yes. And what did you respond with?
My fucking cock. That's what it was. I believe that's
Morning.
Yeah.
Fun Club. The Morning Fun Club. And everybody gets a card. So everybody is in the club. And you have people you sign mean? Up online, get a card. And the card also, you guys can make some money here, discounts. If you're going to be going to see Jim in Ohio, make sure you use your Holiday Inn card.
Denny,
get
like,
10% off.
I know that like you're an old
Why
school.
Why would they use a Holiday Inn card? That's
well,
what I'll be working.
Well, the MFC card, if you will.
I know that like you're obsessed with this idea of like partnering with local businesses and stuff.
Yeah.
You're on a platform that's international. You're not. I need you.
Yeah.
Need you to really, really. Embrace the fact that you are not on local rate. You're taking a sip of water.
Well, if you go to Hawaii.
Yeah.
And you want to go see the Don Ho show.
Yeah.
You present your card.
Uh-huh. They give you a rope and a stool.
MFC. And you could get some free Hawaiian leis.
Ooh. From pretty girls?
Nice? Yes. That's pretty nice.
See,
or one
reason,
of those.
Here's why that was
or
so
a
bad.
Pineapple drink.
Because the reason that Denny said Hawaiian leis was because he thought the little double entendre was funny.
Mm-hmm. Right.
And then, of course, the person to tag it was.
But when I
the
do
chipper.
A party. But when I do a party for children, if I ever do
Yay.
A party for
do you
for Travis's
find that
daughter,
the zipper sounds bring the parents right back in the room?
Yeah, what kind of tell me more about your parties for children.
Everyone's
Daddy.
Frolicking, they get zip and the fauna comes back in.
I call them tropical necklaces though. It's a bit more family
Yeah,
friendly.
Yeah, I call them pearl. Have a tropical necklace.
Would you ever give a child a Hawaiian lei?
Yeah.
No.
If
I
it's
wouldn't.
A tropical party?
You yes. bet I would.
You would.
I'd walk around lead the conga line.
Sure. Put his face in the sand.
Yeah. I don't know why you would need to do that.
Yeah.
Just face in the sand?
No, I wouldn't do that.
You're a Hawaiian lei.
Yeah. That's a little different. But do you ever, what kind of party favors do you have at the kids' parties?
Glow sticks.
Yeah, it's true.
Hand clappers.
Glow and flesh color.
Hand clappers, you know the hand clappers?
Sure, they sound like little spanks.
Yes.
Get your hand clappers.
Hand clappers.
Show me your bottom.
People right. like that. Blow up guitars.
Sure, blow into the guitar tube.
Right, right. Yeah, lots of inflatables, right?
Yes.
Makes the guitar big and fat.
Right.
Get some guitar juice.
Right. Right. Did you miss this?
Yeah.
You did. Okay, yeah. good.
It's fun.
Yeah.
Morning Fun Club, see?
Oh, right.
Feeds right into that.
Everybody's having a good time.
Yeah.
Everybody's having... And so it's not just like the staff and the hosts and stuff to get cards. It's all the listeners. We create a community.
Exactly.
And they get cards.
See, I like that, yeah.
Yeah, because that's what I tell you, because they're saying right now, since it's 2016, the one thing that's making a big comeback is physical media. So you want to get out there and have a physical card that you mail via snail mail.
The app.
What?
The app.
You mean a digital card?
A digital.
Whoa. Maybe this is the future.
They can call up and say what their fun club number is, and we can go, hooah.
Well, we give out you give out a number. All right.
That's stupid. Ron and Fez did that.
Here's the fun club number. You give that out.
Ron and Fez did.
But that's stealing from Ron and Fez.
They did that already. Dennis.
Ronnie did that for years.
We just call it something different.
He called it the big-ass card.
Yeah, the big-ass card. So I don't think the card idea works. It's too close to it, Ron. Yeah. By the way, if you heard Ron's audio yesterday, he was so fucking funny.
Ron the gossip? Gossipy Ron Bennington. Back at it again, running through these halls. He hears all the rumors.
Funny motherfucker, man.
It was great. It was really good.
So, I think the idea of morning fun club, I mean, you're right on all fronts.
Right.
It's the morning.
Yeah.
As of now, I mean, will it remain fun. The morning? We don't know.
We don't know. Is there
midday
room?
Midday fun club sounds like shit.
Yeah. Right. Yeah. Is there room for an evening fun club?
Sure. Let me see. What did Ope used to call it? The other thing, the morning, the nighttime.
Yeah.
The nighttime attitude.
You like that?
The afternoon attitude.
Yeah.
The all afternoon attitude. AAA. And you make the logo like the Automobile Club of America.
You like that?
Yes.
That's not for us, though. That's for him.
All oh, afternoon. My God. Yeah. Hold on.
Yeah. Yeah.
Hold on, this thing finishes after the crash, then you get a call to the lawyer.
What do you think of that sounder?
That's fun.
You like the sounder?
Oh, yeah, it's fun.
What do you think of the fact
that... I like horns.
That when
So when you say something, Jimmy says something funny, you go...
What do you think about the fact that whenever you hear the sounder, before it, you have to hear the scrape of Jim's T-shirt against his microphone?
Yeah, he should have it a little closer.
A little closer, right? Yeah. And maybe the sounder should be not as... long?
Okay.
It's okay. The length is good.
Because people hear that, they go, oh!
That's what they say about Dennis. The length is good. The length is okay. Right?
It ain't the meat, it's the motion.
That's right. As said here on the Morning Fun Club.
It's not what we're calling the show,
the
I don't
Morning
think.
The Morning Fun
that's,
Club.
I might have to veto that.
We need a song for it, though.
Do you sing?
No, I don't, but maybe we could get Wang Chung to redo Everyone Have Fun, Everybody Have Fun Tonight?
Why would they redo
everybody
it? They did it.
Redo it with Everybody Have Fun This Morning.
I love it.
Oh.
Everybody have fun this morning.
There we go.
See, yeah. That's really good, actually. That sounds really catchy.
Yeah.
It's the Morning Fun Club. Jim Norton and Sam Roberts. Morning Fun Club.
There you go.
That's something there.
Morning has broken.
I don't think there is.
A lot of morning songs.
What were you saying?
Morning Has Broken, Cat Stevens.
I see.
That's too heavy, though.
Yeah. I see.
We don't need a Morning Has Broken.
Yeah.
It's got to be fun and upbeat, happy and peppy and bursting with love.
There you go. Thank you.
Yeah.
Felix.
You know what actually could make a lot of people fun and upbeat right now?
What?
We'll see you later, man.
Anytime, my friend. You know where to find me. I have an office now. We close the door, sit down, and, you know, hash this
awesome.
Stuff out.
It's like a Les Nessman office. It's just a fucking tape around where the office would be.
And just remember, no idea is a bad idea.
That's true. Yeah. You've come up with a bunch of them.
I'll keep trying, though.
No, well.
I won't stop till we reach the top.
You know, they put him in an office, Dennis.
Good, they should have. He deserves an office. One in the corner where Scott is. Dennis should be running this fucking place.
You think so?
Yes!
You think so?
Morning Fun Club agrees.
I don't know. That's not. I hope you're not speaking for me when you say that.
The Morning Fun Club agrees.
Well, I mean, I don't know who exactly the Morning Fun Club is.
I just want to see everybody get along because I like everybody, all the parties involved here.
Right.
I like you. I like, you know, Jimmy.
You do.
I like Opie.
Oh.
I like Anthony. I wish everybody could come back home for the holidays.
That's not happening.
That's right. No, it's not gonna.
Some people are refusing to come home for the holidays, but they feel like their family's keeping them out. But we're not.
Dennis. When you were a kid, when you were like in high school, say.
Yes.
Did you used to walk through the halls wondering, what is everybody laughing at? And then realize they were laughing at you?
We're not laughing with you, we're laughing at you.
Now, right. What are they laughing at?
Do you have any idea why Mars and Adrian are crying with laughter as they sit behind you?
They're just enjoying the fun.
Oh, is that right?
They're part of the Morning Fun Club.
Okay, Jim's in on it. I am still not in on it.
Interesting.
Paul, are you aware?
Huh?
Okay, Paul has become aware.
Probably the dancing that I'm doing.
No, it's not the dancing. I am still blissfully unaware. So, I don't know. Do I want to see the...
joke's on me.
Well, Adrian, let
me see.
They
I don't like
something out, which might
I don't
be
like the jokes.
Dennis
on you,
is feeling his pants real quick. There's no shit in them.
Dennis,
make sure we post it.
Can I ask you a question?
Yes.
Let me see. Do you?
I didn't see the video.
Do you? Do you feel the need to keep in shape? You do, right?
Yeah.
Do you like to exercise?
No, not particularly.
Do you like to combine exercise with daily routines?
Sure.
Let me ask you this. Are there any muscles that you try to work out more than others?
No.
You don't try to work out, like, do you work out, like, your thighs at all, or? Not the thighs, right? They're fine. Maybe the calves?
My arms.
Your arms a little bit.
Chest.
What about the glutes, the gluteus?
No, I don't have much of that back here.
It's not true.
Well, it's kind of hanging.
Let me ask you a question, Dennis. The great staff of, I guess, the members of your Morning Fun Club have pointed out that when you talk, you flex your ass cheeks.
Just moving.
You clench your cheeks as you talk. Like it's not your hips. Like you're clenching your cheeks while you talk. So it's like with each syllable, you clench like you're working out. Like a lady does Kegel exercises.
Kegel.
Kegel.
Not Kegel. It's an alcoholic lady.
Like a lady does Kegel exercises. You.
Spin?
No. Kegel your what appears to be your rectum.
I don't know. I don't think so.
You don't think you work out the old asshole while you go?
I don't think so.
No. You ever stand here while you're having a conversation like, oh, it's not as tight as it used to be? That's been loosened up a little bit.
No, I'm always moving.
You don't tighten up those finger grippers?
No. No, I don't.
You know what he meant? Because he looked at his fingers and then he heard grippers at the end of it and it was like, oh.
Yeah, the video looks like Denny is tightening up his butt cheeks a little bit.
Maybe we'll let the... Morning. Maybe that can be the first assignment of the Morning Fun Club.
Whatever you want.
Is we'll post the video on Twitter, and then we'll see what the Fun Club thinks of it.
Yeah, I'm sure we'll get a lot of nice positive feedback.
You think so? You think so? Mm-hmm. Well, welcome back, Denny.
Anytime, Sam. Always good seeing you here around the day.
It's great seeing you, Denny. We all very much love you. And a lot of people, including us, we consider you our Lord. You know, we pray to you. So
yes.
So you are
just being a friend.
Denny is God.
He is. He's the God of radio. He's as godly as it comes.
Well, good luck to you and Jim.
All right.
The best. Did you like my other name the other day?
What's the other name?
Well, because some people call Jim like Jimbo.
You wanted to call our name the Erection Circus.
No,
yesterday.
No. And they call you Sam. So it'd be Jimbo and Sam.
Mm-hmm.
Sambo. What'd you think of that one?
It's got racial connotations.
Nah.
All right, here's an idea that I just had. This could be fun. You get the fuck out of here, and we're going to ask the Bellas if they want to come in.
Sure.
Yeah. Okay, that sounds like a great idea, right? That sounds...
Of course.
Thank you. Morning Fun Club, welcome.
Welcome. Welcome to the Ass Clench Club.
Bala.
All right. You going to say your deal? You were done?
I was on, and now I'm gone.
Okay, there you go. Dennis Falcone, everybody. Dennis Falcone. Just terrific. Just terrific. The video is up. We're doing it for now on the Opie with Jim Twitter. You can see Denny clenching his cheeks. They're coming in. You can see his cheeks clenching as he talks. And it's just fun. He's right. There is some fun to the morning.
Morning Fun Club.
You think he thought when he came in here pitching his suggestions, he would get mocked because he clenches? Okay, 2 minutes? Okay. Yeah. Okay.
How do you even do it that fast?
I don't know. Come in.
Oh.
Come in. Welcome. How are you? We're live. So.
Oh, you're live.
Yeah.
I'm going to jump on a mic then.
Jump on a mic. Nikki Bella.
Sam?
Hi.
How are you? Do you know Jim Norton?
Yeah. Jim, I feel like we've met before.
Hey.
Hello. Your face looks super familiar.
How are you?
Yeah.
Cool. Have you ever been chased down the street?
Actually, you? Yeah. One time I was chased down the street, actually, Bree and I, by Amy Schumer.
Is that right?
Yeah.
Actually, in Nashville.
Yeah.
Nashville, why? Tennessee.
We walked into this bar to hear guitar playing, and we heard it for a bit, had a few beers, and we walked out. And we hear someone yelling our name, and we turn, and it was Amy, and she had just got done filming Trainwreck with John.
Mm-hmm.
So it was a while ago, and she's like, oh, I just want to say I'm a huge fan of Total Divas. It was great to work with John, blah, blah, blah. We took a photo. So, yeah, we have been chased.
Oh, nice.
Yeah.
Jim, Nicole is dating John Cena.
Yes.
IRL in real life.
Okay.
And Brie is married to Daniel Bryan.
Yes.
Oh, okay. So you're deep in the wrestling community.
Very we are. So. Okay.
Well, and Nicole is one of the SmackDown female superstars.
That's right. Oh. And the longest reigning champion. Too. And just kidding.
What you, Brie? I feel like you retired. And the word was, you know, spend more time with family and everything. And then immediately, your husband's...
All my family's on the road.
Back, yeah. Your sister's back on the road.
It's funny how life
works. And it's funny because at SmackDown, it's literally my mom's husband is Johnny Ace, who used to is a former wrestler. Okay. And People Power, you might have known him on WWE. So we literally have turned into like wrestling royalty. It's pretty crazy.
Yeah.
But so on Tuesdays, I get to see my stepdad, Johnny Ace, and I have my love, John Cena, there, and then my brother-in-law, Daniel Bryan. And it's like a big family event.
Except Brie's not there.
Yeah, except Brie and my mom are doing like sleepovers together because they're missing their men.
I get scared to stay home alone. But it's nice because Brian and I do get a lot more time together, and, you know, we're trying to start a family, so... It's a bigger process than what I realized.
Do you get mad when Brian had to retire because of concussions. Like, he got a lot of concussions. They were saying at one point they were getting so serious that he was having seizures. Like,
right.
WWE was just like, you can't be in a ring anymore. We won't allow you to.
Right.
But, like, I feel like every interview that I read that he does, he says, no, I'm getting back in a ring. I want to get back in a ring. They won't let me, but I'm trying to convince them.
It's so frustrating. I feel like it's our biggest argument in our marriage. But it's, of course he would love to, you know, but we don't get to choose our health, unfortunately.
How old is he?
He's 35.
Okay, that's not old to be retiring, so I get why you're 35 and you still want to do it.
Well, and it happened out of nowhere for him. But, you know, unfortunately, it's just that... you don't get to choose your health and what, you know, happens to your body, but we do get to choose our next 20 years of life, our next 50 years, which we're lucky that WWE does have good doctors and that they care.
Yeah.
And I'm like, Brian, the minute that we have a baby and you hold that baby, it's all going to be over. And, you know, Shawn Michaels told him that. He's like, you don't care about your body and everything that happens to it until you have a child. And he's like, wrestling becomes way down here because that child takes over your whole life. And I think that's what he needs. So I need to hurry up.
So you're just trying to get knocked out as quickly as possible. Yeah. So you can. Well, that sounds fun.
It is. Turn into work for Brian.
What do you think he should do? Like, if he can't wrestle, what should he do? Should he teach it, or should he go to school?
Yeah, well, he actually did get accepted to ASU, but then WWE called and he got the job as a GM, the GM of SmackDown, which he's loving.
Oh, okay. So he's like on camera.
Helps out with you know, some creative. He's the host on Talking Smack on the WWE
Network.
Which is
amazing.
It's really good.
He was commentating with Mauro on the Cruiserweight Classic on the WWE Network, which he loved. And so I think for him, it was like he was going to school to do permaculture, and then all of a sudden all this came, and he gets to still be a part of wrestling.
Okay. Yeah. What's permaculture?
So it's a style of living where you let your... You put your land together in its natural habitat, and you can live off your land. So we live in the desert, so we have desert plants and where they're planted, and they can kind of grow on their own and produce food without using too much water. We use, like, the natural water that Arizona gives us.
My accountant gave me a small cactus.
And, so you get it.
I don't know how much to water it. I'm afraid of drowning it. Like,
That would be, I wonder.
Cacti absorb water, though. You don't need to water them that much, right?
That's what I'm saying. I don't know.
Once a week, maybe?
Maybe.
Yeah,
Yeah. I put a giant glass in every day.
Well, Total Bellas is the show that's coming out first. You're still going to be on Total Divas?
Yes, we'll still be on Total Divas.
So Total Bellas is Wednesday, October 5th, 8 p.m. only on E!
So you're dragging...
6 episodes.
And you're dragging John Cena and Daniel Bryan into becoming full-fledged, like, reality TV husbands.
They have the
road
choice. No, I'm just kidding. They do.
They actually were excited about Total Bellas because, especially Brian, because he's like, finally, everyone can hear from me. He sits in the interview chair. He gets to tell his perspective about stuff going on. And I think the really important thing about Total Bellas for Brian is that you see him go through the process of finding out the bad news of never being able to wrestle again. And he tried so hard to be strong about it, but he couldn't.
Right.
And you kind of see him...
you know, just not take it well. And I think people will relate with that, you know, when your dreams get taken from you. But, you know, right. as we see now, he's the GM SmackDown and he's loving it. So there's a positive ending to it.
That's
which
like
is great.
Yeah. Jim performed stand up for a long time, but then realized he was not funny. And so he had to give up.
I wound up giving
stand-up
up my
would be
dream.
Scary.
It is. So I wound up speaking. I give dramatic talks now.
I love it.
I would love a dramatic talk.
But it's like I just do my act, but like people stare and I go, but
all kidding aside. They walk away inspired.
They really do. I just keep saying all kidding aside, folks. And it really works out really well. They
I
know
love
that's
it.
Great. That's great.
I think you would be great at stand up.
I don't know. I mean, I've done it and it was just hard and it was scary.
Well, there's a comedy store or something in Phoenix, Arizona. I'm sure they need talent there, so you can come there.
So that wouldn't be me.
Well, everybody watched the show. Thank you for stopping by real quick. We stole you from one of your interviews. And by the way, too, John Cena did this promo, as it's called in wrestling, on Talking Smack, where I felt like he was just being himself.
Yeah.
He was amazing.
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 I was actually, well, it's cute because he called me out because I literally was just sitting there, like, staring at him watching because I just love everything he does.
Mm-hmm.
And I was like, oh, wow. And, like, I loved it because if you go back and look at Renee Young, like, you even see her arms start getting super red. And I was, like, thinking, like, oh, is she getting super mad?
Talking Smack is great. It gets
it's
very
the
real
best. I
there.
Love it, but John, he's just, man, he's amazing.
Sam, I will say I was a little sad at WrestleMania, or no, it was SummerSlam. I saw you retired the Brie Mode shirt.
Because there was no Brie.
That's okay, I get it.
Do you want me to keep wearing it?
No.
I just wear
I guess
it
you
forever.
You don't have to, but I was a little hurt.
Brie, no. You want to be a mom so he can retire the shirt.
I am going to make a comeback after I have my first child.
Are
so
you?
That shirt better go back on. Yeah,
well,
hell yeah, I am.
Well, now I've been intimidated.
Until you get into Brie
it.
Mode. And then you can make your home. Oh. We're headed to Napa Valley next week, and it's like no Brie Mode. It's
you
like
gonna,
so
you gonna
not
take
fun.
A nap when you're there?
See, it doesn't work. We're gonna take a quick break. Quick single break. Thank you very much, ladies.
Thank you.
And we'll
Thank
be back
you.
Right after this.
Okay.
Jim is taking a leak. Here he comes. Welcome back. We're wrapping up. Jim Norton and Sam Roberts here. We'll be doing Sam Roberts Show live tonight and tomorrow at 9 p.m. Eastern here on the channel. And, of course, Jim, all weekend, will be at Levity Live in West Nyack. It's in the Palisades Mall.
And I'm still coming to D.C., by the way, next Friday.
Ooh.
I'm still doing the Lincoln Theater. I'm just shooting after the election here in New York.
My, my.
I can't wait to. I'm very, very fucking psyched.
The Bellas didn't know you were a comedian.
No, I kind of took that.
They're hot, though.
Oh, the girl with them I thought was beautiful. Who is she?
I think she's their makeup girl.
Oh, my God.
Yeah.
She's amazing.
Yeah.
But I can't compete in that world. I can't compete in the world of better-looking comedians. There's no way anyone who's dating John Cena or people who hang out with wrestlers, I have zero shot.
Yeah. No, I mean, it is what it is.
Yeah.
She is. John Cena, they're trying to turn into, like, the next guy. They're trying to make him, like, the next Rock. Like, they're trying to make him be the guy that crosses over.
He's very popular, right?
Very popular. Very popular. So, if anybody can get something like that done, it would definitely be him.
Do you think I look like him at all?
John Cena, let me look at you. No. Not even a little bit. There's not even a slight resemblance. Let's go to the Teft Box for opinion. Teft!
Yeah, Teft Box?
Well, I already gave you my opinion on the interview.
What was it?
Yeah, Teft was mad because I didn't bring up French Bulldogs.
They both own French Bulldogs, so it's like that's like the first thing you want to talk about, right?
No.
Yeah, so what's that hybrid animal that suffocates every night in your apartment? How's that?
Yeah.
How's that mongoloid animal fucking...
Exactly.
I mean, mine's just fine.
They should be extinct, French Bulldogs.
No.
Yeah, they should be.
Terrible idea.
You know how we should start? Killing all the ones that are alive.
Exactly.
Yeah.
Whenever you buy a French Bulldog, they should give you a hammer so the first time you get this thing snoring...
That'd be a really brutal way to kill it.
Well, it's got to be quick. You know, 9 or 10 swipes is done. Start with the back. You start with this little back leg.
Right. So you just kill it systematically.
Yeah, you break all four of its legs, and you work your way up the spine until it just gives up, jumps.
And by the way, getting attacked by a hammer is not more painful than this dog's. Travis's dog is 9 years old.
Yeah.
It's not more painful than 9 years of wheezing and sniffing and trying to figure out how to breathe out of a contraption that God did not create.
Yeah, exactly.
He's the best.
It's like breathing into your ear. What's his name?
Dexter.
Oh, I forgot.
Can you imagine that? Living life, trying to just push oxygen out and suck it back in through your ears?
Yes, I have been. Well, I think I'm better breathing. Yes, I can.
He doesn't know any better.
Well, yeah, no, he's a stupid idiot.
He's unhappy. He's a stupid dog.
He's just an unhappy dog.
He's not unhappy. He's very happy.
Not.
Yeah.
I wonder if the Bellas are... are worried now that the ass-kissing bandit is on the loose.
Their makeup girl was so beautiful.
You liked her?
Whew. Damn.
What if she's dating a wrestler, too?
I don't have any shot left.
That's not true, Jim. Your wit can outslam the biggest power slam. Bless you.
Somebody one time told me I had a rapier wit, and I said, how'd you know? And I was like, oh, I misunderstood. Hold on a second.
Slow work. What do you think, Paul? Do we leave that sound effect or we replace it?
We can add more.
You think so?
Don't get the panda angry!
Oh, you're over here now. Okay.
I'm over here now.
Do you see the ass-kissing bandit?
No, but I heard about him.
So, Kim Kardashian is walking around.
Oh, man, she has a booty.
Yeah, I know. Speaking of booty, by the way, if you go to, I guess, at Opie with Jim for now on Twitter.
Why would you?
You can see, the only reason is because you can see the rapid movements of Dennis Falcone's ass cheeks.
Twitter.
Yeah?
Yes.
All right, somebody send me the video
take
so
this
I can.
Down.
I can.
I'm sure he wants it down too. Our show is dead. Like, let it.
Then somebody text it to me, and we'll put it. We'll put it up. But we bring up asses because Kim Kardashian. Do you know what part of the world was Kim Kardashian in?
Paris.
Ooh, ooh la la.
She was in Gay Patty. You like Paris?
It's also my nickname for the Tef Box. Gay Pally.
And she's just walking around or whatever. And this dude, and when I heard the story, I thought he looks like a normal dude.
Yeah.
He's not like, he doesn't look like a weirdo. He actually looks like he's an in-shape guy. He dresses well.
Thanks, dude.
I date him, you know? But.
Ew.
But he jumps out of a crowd. And he tries to just plant a little peck on Kim Kardashian's ass. Watch this. Watch this. Go ahead.
Kim! Kim!
Kim! He just runs out. Oh, they knocked his hat off. Did you see how quick they knocked his hat off?
Yeah. That's rapey. You can't put your fucking mouth on a lady's ass.
It's gross.
What a jerk off.
It's gross.
These guys who are jumping out just to touch these women, they really should be handled with a fucking sledgehammer.
Well, what do you think? I mean, I look at that and it just strikes me as, I mean, creepy and unallowable, but silly. Like, I don't know. Do you think this guy, you know more about the world of kink than I do. Do you think this guy gets off on this?
Nah, I don't know. I think it might just be a silly thing. But yeah. The bottom line is it's over. It's like grabbing someone's tits.
Do you know about this guy?
No, I don't know.
This is what he does.
There actually is an ass-kissing bandit?
No, he's like, he's this prankster who lives over there, and he physically accosts celebrities on the red carpet.
That's not
like, if you go to his Wikipedia, like, it's a whole list of people that he's done this to.
What a fucking asshole.
He's a jerk-off. You guys are jerk-off.
It's not a prank to just assault somebody. Like, yeah. It's not.
A prank is asking stupid questions. But trying to kiss somebody's ass is just, it's like, who the fuck do you think you are?
Like, if you kiss somebody on the ass cheek, and then you jump back and you go, gotcha, then the other person would be like, what are you talking about? Like, no.
He was arrested in L.A. for breaking Brad Pitt's glasses.
I think I know who this guy is.
Yeah,
I think
too bad he would have seen his marriage crumbling.
You mean if he had his glasses?
At least it's topical.
Yeah. Because it's... You can get there.
Yep.
You know
just
what?
Just like when Ant used to do it.
No, it's not. It's not. And you know what? It's better. New show, new car crash.
That's right. Who needs Ant? That was the way. That was the button push. Yeah. I do that better than he did.
That's
and
right.
You can tell him I said that. I pushed the button better. My car crash is longer.
That's right. That's right. And there's a lot more hype built up to it. You build some anticipation for it.
That's right. There's like that. Nothing like that 30-second pause before the car crash.
You can get arrested for it, I'm sure, for what the guy did. But I don't know. He's not going to do anything. He'll just be back. Oh, there they are beating the shit out of him. Oh, that's Brad Pitt being attacked.
Who punched him?
think he leaned forward.
He leaned forward to grab him.
Ended up bumping into him.
People are such assholes.
Somebody's got to break bones on this dude.
Somebody will. He'll do it. It's funny. I would like to see him do it to the wrong person.
Yeah, I would love it. I would love for him to, like...
Do it to Fabricio Verdun when he's going through.
Exactly.
Try to kiss his wife on the ass.
You know, who didn't look like the type of guy that would enjoy a fun red carpet prank?
Oh.
Tyron Woodley. He struck me as the type of guy that maybe you wouldn't do that to.
Or Ronda Rousey. You know how fast you'd be eating a fist?
If he just tried to, like, pinch her nipple or something?
You know, good luck with...
I would love it.
Oh, no, my zipper's open in our UFC picture.
Oh. What a... You know something, Jim? You are a true putz.
Oh, no. My zipper's open.
It is. All the big, tough men around you and me and you with your zipper open.
Can't help it.
Well...
No one noticed. Fucking big dick pushing things through.
Can I tell you something?
Sure.
People noticed. I saw it on Twitter.
Did they?
Yeah, people were like, Jim's zipper's open. Like, yeah, his fly's open.
This one opens a lot. I can't help it. It's a new zipper.
If we do this again, I'll have a little code for you. I'll go like this. Jim.
XYZ. No, I don't like that. How about this? If you see it, mm-hmm. you just put your head in my lap and bob for 40 minutes.
40?
And I'll say, well, Sam's been blowing me for 40 minutes. My zipper must be open.
Oh, my God. Well, I guess that's it for the show today.
Yeah, I hope people liked it. Who knows?
I liked it. I thought it was a good show.
We don't know what's going to happen. I'm sure, let's see if there's more Twitter shenanigans or, look. And I really hope Opie listens to what was said. If he wants to argue it out, I would rather argue on the air. Like,
yeah.
Just to a dog. I don't need to do it in a Twitter thing. It's like, because nobody understands each other on Twitter.
Trigger fingers turn to Twitter fingers.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I'll just argue. If you want to argue, then argue. But everyone, stop expecting. I'm not going to reach out to you.
This is kind of what you do for a living, right? Like, you know, like this is the place to do it.
Yeah, this is the radio show. I don't know what to say about it. I don't want to degenerate into fucking, I really don't. And it has nothing to do with being afraid. It has nothing to do with Greg Shells or any of that stuff people think. I just don't want it to get to a place where we're fucking hating each other and being nasty to each other. But,
yeah,
you know, I won't fire that first nasty shot. I'm going to tell you, but I will not tolerate that. You're telling me I don't have integrity. It's not going to happen.
That's fair.
So that instinct you have to hit the send button on that. You should rethink, just like I have rethought things that I would want to say.
Right. What does this lead to? What are the ramifications of this?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Because everything I have said, multiple people can attest to.
Yes. I truly hope he signs. I hope Opie is here. I hope he's here doing a show. I hope, I know you'll be here doing a show.
Yeah.
I'm going to be doing
I told you weeks ago.
Yeah, you called me. I'm gonna be doing my show tonight at 9 p.m. Eastern, as well as tomorrow at 9 p.m. And I'm hopefully by Friday at 9 p.m. there will be a clearer view of what this will all look like.
It would be nice to know exactly what's happening. I know that we're not here Monday.
Right, we won't be here Monday.
But that was a pre-planned thing that was supposed to be.
Tuesday, I'm scheduled to be here on Tuesday.
I think I am too.
All right.
I just don't know the time.
Right, right. Well, you'll learn as we do it. And by the way, like...
It's funny if it was just Jim and Opie again and we just pretended this never happened.
That'd be great.
Guys, start talking.
We're not going to address it.
We're not going to say anything. Chris, what's going on?
But yeah, there's nobody in this room has any desire to be mysterious about this or has any desire to hold any information back. As I'm assuming I'm talking for you, Jim, as we get the information, you will have the information.
Yeah. And it's not, I don't put up, have I ever in all the years, like I've said a lot of unfunny things. I've done a lot of dumb things. And
yeah, that good point.
Nodding Teft head back there. It's funny. Not once does he nod during the whole show, but as soon as I said, all of a sudden somebody's focused.
He looked up from his iPhone and be like, yeah.
Yeah. I'm going to miss him. But no, it's, look, man, I'm not mysterious. You know what I mean? It's like, I try to. You know, again, there's things I've withheld for whatever reason, but I'm not going to put up weird videos. You know, just do it. Opie was supposed to be here this week.
Yes.
This is his radio show up until Friday. And then I don't know if he's going to sign or not.
Right.
But to think that we snuck around and made the company do anything is ludicrous. It's ludicrous and simply not accurate. So I'm not saying I'm perfect and that the fans should believe every single word I've ever said, but I hope in all the years that you've known me, the things I've told you about my personal life, mm-hmm. and as forthcoming as I've been about a lot of things in my life, I hope you know that I'm not all of a sudden turning into a fucking blatant liar. I'm not. That's not what's happening.
Well, good. Well, there it is. You know, so
there are things I'm in denial about myself, I think.
But that has nothing to do with radio. That's more of... romantically.
Just me in the mirror wondering out loud. This was fun, man. I hope it continues, but I enjoy Sam very much and Travis, and thank you the guys for making this a fun
Yeah, everybody's week. Been awesome this week.
They've been what?
Oh, thank you.
Awesome sauce.
Except Roland yesterday, who took the day off to meet Bruce Springsteen.
I didn't blame
which,
Roland.
By the way, 100%. 100% I would have done the
same
thing.
Do you wish that that would have gone badly?
Oh, I wish there was a story to tell today. I wish there was a photo of, like, their feet. I wish, like, he had gotten to the bookstore and Bruce left right before he got there. Something. I wish he'd gotten the time wrong. I wish he'd fallen asleep on the train.
Yeah.
Anything. Anything would have just made my day. It would have been delightful. But yeah, so I'll see you tonight, and beyond that...
I'm not going to be here tonight.
Not you. Talking to the audience.
All right, guys.
But beyond that, in some way, shape, or form, Jim and I will both be here next week.
Let me close it out. I got something funny to do.
Oh, shit.